Good morning and welcome to the first meeting in 2023 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. I wish you all a Happy New Year. We have a single item on our agenda which involves taking evidence on the Scottish Budget 23-24 from two panels of witnesses. First, we'll hear from the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body on its own budget bid, and then we'll take evidence from the Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for COVID recovery. I now move to the first panel of witnesses, Jackson Carlock, MSP, member of the Scottish Parliament Corporate Body, who is joined today by Scottish Parliament officials David McGill, Clerk and Chief Executive, Michelle Hegarty, Deputy Chief Executive, and Sarah Glass, Group Head of Financial Governance. I welcome you all to the meeting. Mr Carlock, I understand you'd like to make a short opening statement.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to members of the committee. A Happy New Year to all of you, and it's a pleasure, I think, to be back to present yet another budget on behalf of the corporate body. And I'll just take a brief moment to set in context our 23-24 budget bid. Core bid reflects commitments already made to this committee in respect of our medium-term financial plan. However, given the volatility of the wider economy, especially inflation, the corporate body have carefully assessed risk to our operations in constructing this year's budget, and accordingly it reflects a few key aspects I would wish to highlight. Last year, the SPCB advised the committee that in the first budget of the new session, we sought to address staffing resources capacity and capability challenges as committed to the convener of the Finance and Constitution Committee in February of 2021 prior to the last election, and confirmed that following this investment, we intended to steward our resources, managing pressures and uncertainties for the duration of this session. The budget bid for 23-24 is consistent with that commitment to steward our resources, and the staffing baseline is exactly in line with the approved bid from this time last year. We also acknowledged then the emerging volatility and inflation, which has become increasingly so in 22-23 and is therefore the biggest factor impacting upon the 23-24 budget bid. As the committee will appreciate, inflation impacts across all aspects of the SPCB cost base, and current levels are driving cost increases largely ahead of those forecast when preparing the indicative budget last year for 23-24. Albeit our bid does also reflect efforts to minimise the inflationary impact. The continued inflationary uncertainty remains our biggest financial and therefore operational risk. For MSPs and ministerial salaries, I can confirm that since we broke the link in pay with Westminster in 2016, we have consistently used ASH as our index as set out in advance in the scheme. We have resolved to continue to do so at present. This year it is at 1.5%, and I would like to highlight that this 1.5% increase is not intended as any form of virtue signalling. We are simply applying the ASH index at the published rate and continue to follow this approach. It normally lags behind increases in sector pay, and therefore we would anticipate that it would lead to a higher recommended increase in the forthcoming year were we using the Indus. I'm happy to discuss any wider questions that arise from this shortly. Turning to staff cost provision, which provides resourcing for members' staffing needs, we have chosen to adopt a slightly different approach to indexation this year. Since the March 2020, the SPCB have indexed the staff cost provision annually using a mix of average weekly earnings, AWE, and the ASH index. For this budget, applying the same methodology based on the recent ASH publication derived an increase of 4.1%, which was lower than the increase in the previous financial year. However, with general inflation tracking at greater than 11%, when we composed the budget, the corporate body have chosen to adopt only the AWE index, which is 5.6%, and this results in a rate of £147,000 of resource per member for employing staff. Following a thorough prioritisation exercise, the total project expenditure budget of £5.2 million is exactly in line with the indicative budget for projects for 23-24. We have a significant change in profile of spend in this bid, driven by the need to fund the Building Energy Management System, BEMS, which is at the end of its operational life. As well as controlling building services such as heating, ventilation and cooling, the system is also a key enabler in allowing the Parliament to achieve its net zero ambitions. Now, the SPCB were taken on a guided tour of the bowels of the Scottish Parliament complex, And the committee would be very welcome to have a tour arranged for them too, if we have any budding plant engineers amongst the committee members to rival those from the retail sector who were challenging me last year. I hope and ensure that that would allow you to understand the very important need to ensure that the building is operating effectively. But recognising the committee's interest in these projects, you will note the enhancements made to Schedule 3 with the inclusion of a new section on multi-year projects. As the committee knows, office holder resourcing is an ongoing SPCB responsibility. This is also a constantly evolving landscape as the Parliament continues to add additional responsibilities or create new office holders. There were only two when the Parliament was established, and clearly we have far more now. The office holders' draft 23-24 budget submissions total £16.6 million, which is £1.2 million, 8.1% higher than the 22-23 budget, and £0.8 million, 800,000, 5.4% higher than the indicative forecast. The main changes in these budgets from 22-23 reflect additional resourcing increases in the Ethical Standards Commissioner, largely arriving from the Section 22 order, and the Scottish Human Rights Commission to address business needs. In recognition of the prevailing inflationary challenges, and finally, the associated risk and uncertainty to make spend to major spend categories, the budget includes an additional £500,000 in our contingency provision for 23-24. The SPCB have carefully considered where some of these risks might materialise, and we are assured that this modest extra contingency provision affords us the best opportunity to address these potential risks. And that, Convener, concludes my remarks highlighting the areas in the budget that I thought I should draw to your attention.
Thank you very much. That was actually very helpful, and I'll obviously be starting off asking questions, and what I'll be saying to colleagues is if they can direct all questions to Jackson, and he will then decide whether he answers them or indeed whether he takes a fifth and palms them off to one of his colleagues. I think we'll start near the end, I suppose, which is really in terms of the Commissioners and Ombudsman budget bid, because as you highlighted, that's quite a significant increase, and indeed the money now being spent on Commissioners and Ombudsmen is now £3 million more than, for example, MSPs. MSPs increase 17,000. And as you pointed out, the increase is about 1.2 million in terms of these office holders. Now, you talked about the Commissioner for Ethical Standards in Scotland. I mean, that budget is increased by 40.5%. And you talked about a Section 22 order. Now, in salaries alone, the £463,000 increase is equivalent to, it says, 7.4 full-time positions, and that's an average of £55,000 each for those positions. So I'm just wondering if you can explain to us the necessity of that, because on paper, obviously, looks, particularly at a time of financial challenge, a very significant increase indeed.
I think there are two very important questions arising here. The first is the whole issue of the commissioners, the way that they are managed and the ongoing cost associated with them. And if you'll allow me, I'll draw to the committee's attention the fact that there are several more commissioners currently envisaged either by government or as a consequence of members' bills progressing through the Parliament. It's not the corporate body's responsibility to comment on the righteousness or otherwise of any of this. It is simply a case that the corporate body is left with a partial function, that is to ensure that they are adequately resourced and that there is a governance structure in place. It is thereafter for the committees of Parliament to interrogate the individual commissioners on the efficiency with which they are undertaking their responsibility. The committee will be aware of the recent history in relation to the Ethical Standards Office, with the departure of the previous commissioner after a period of some controversy. And as a consequence of that, the very severe report that was prepared by the Audit Commission, was the Audit Scotland, into the whole conduct and function of the office. In consequence of that, the Standards Commission have applied a Section 22 or have applied a series of requirements which are quite exhaustive in terms of the burden placed upon the Ethical Standards Commissioner in the way that all complaints, and there have been significantly more of them, have to be investigated. And that has a significant effect in terms of the requirement for additional staffing. Now, the corporate body has spent some time interrogating this budget. It's not that we simply rolled over and said, well, this is a lovely idea. Not, because we are mindful of the additional costs. I have, all the time I've been in the corporate body in the last session on this, I have never had any commissioner come to me suggesting they reduce their budget. So the corporate body is acutely aware of the increasing budget for commissioners. But given the responsibilities that have been placed upon the Ethical Standards Commissioner, we felt that this was a budget we had to approve. In saying that, we have written to the Standards Commission, not questioning in any way their right or their authority to make the recommendations that they have, but seeking just to clarify, because we would want to review these budgets on an ongoing basis, whether they thought this would be for a prolonged period of time. They certainly don't think that they will be changing their requirements on the Ethical Standards Commissioner in the current financial year or probably the next. So we are anticipating that we will have to maintain, or the Ethical Standards Commissioner will need to maintain, that level of staffing in order to be effective in the immediate period ahead. I think that covers it.
Okay, thanks. I mean, it's not a criticism of the SPCB. I think, obviously, because this is a public meeting, I think it's important for people to be able to understand where their money is actually going. The other thing I think it's significant with regard to commissioners and ombudsmen is that every single one of them is increasing by higher than the actual budget that you've bid for the entire Parliament. So what you're bidding for is a 4.8% increase from 128 to 134.2 million. But every single one of them is increasing above that, the average being 8.1%. So it looks as if that this is... And if you actually look at compared to the draft budget in terms of areas where, you know, whether it's justice or transport or whatever, local government, whatever it be, one can argue that the budgets of these office bearers are increasing by all of these kind of frontline services. And so I think it's important to put on the public record why that's happening. The other one, of course, that stands out is the Scottish Commission for Human Rights, which has also had a significant increase of 22%. I mean, has there been a big deterioration in human rights in Scotland in the last year, or is it just that they're now dotting more I's, crossing more T's? What's the situation?
Again, I think it's important to emphasise that we do interrogate these budgets carefully. And what you see before you is not necessarily reflective of everything that the corporate body has been asked to approve. I mean, we have actually declined to approve certain requests for additional funding and have sought to find other ways to achieve the outcome that was desired. The Scottish Human Rights Commissioner made a case in relation to the requirement for additional two additional full-time staff, which the corporate body in due course accepted. I think that I'm trying to remember if that was less than the actual bid that we received. I think in that case it was.
Less.
Yeah, so the bid was in fact for significantly more of an increase than we finally approved. So we did interrogate that quite carefully and declined to accept the full request that we received.
I don't want to spend a lot of time on this, but 242,000 is our increase. And you're talking about for two additional members of staff. There must be more to it than that, surely. I mean,
Well, I mean, it includes also general pay increases for those staff that are already there. So, I mean, you know, it
just seems a very...
Which, of course, as you know, are again running ahead of where it was anticipated they would be when the budgets were prepared last year.
Yeah, I mean, I'm just trying to put it into context with the rest of the where the Scottish Consolidated Fund is going to be spent. You know, there's not going to be many areas that are going to have that level of increase, and yet each one of these has. So, I think that's something.
That's the point you make. But can I just say that to follow on the second point?
Yeah.
We are also potentially looking at a patient safety commissioner, a victims commissioner, the police investigations and review commissioner, disability commissioner, an older people's commissioner, a future generations commissioner, HM inspector for education, and a learning disability, autism and neurodiversity commissioner. If Parliament, and this is for Parliament to decide, were to progress all of these commissioners, it is a very considerable additional increase that will be falling into the officeholder responsibility. And I should say that, mindful of that, the corporate body, although we've not arrived at any conclusions yet, are also looking at the way we as a corporate body might seek to manage that. Because as those members here, and I know Liz Smith was on the corporate body, will know, our opportunity to discuss office holders falls within the agenda of our normal business. And clearly, as the number of commissioners is expanding significantly, in order for us to do justice to that, we're going to have to give some further thought to what the implications would be. But this may be a matter in terms of the additional commissioners that this committee might want to discuss with other committees of the Parliament when they give consideration to the implications and consequences that arise from it.
OK, well, we'll move on from there. I think you've raised really, really interesting points. I'll certainly be taking them up in other places with other people. Now, in terms of the staffing budget, generally, there's a 6.7% increase overall, and you have explained some of that. But I'm just wondering, in the document we've been provided with, it says staff pay, including use of contractors, budgeted at £37.3 million, a net increase of £2.3 million in cash terms. So I'm just wondering whether what the breakdown is between contractors and our own staff.
Happy, and I'm going to ask Sarah to take that one.
Morning. In terms of how we budget, we have a really small budget for contractors. It's like £4,000 is all we budget for. So the bulk of the staffing budget is for our own staff. When needed, we will use contractors to fill those positions on a temporary basis if we find that we can't recruit the permanent positions. But in terms of how we budget, it's a very small amount that's in contractors and staff pay.
That's absolutely fine. It's just that, you know, if you've got a £37 million budget and it says, including use of contractors, you anticipate it's going to be a lot more than £4,000. So it might have been easier just to say, including £4,000 for contractors. That would have saved me having to ask you that question. The other thing I was going to ask on staffing baselines is that in 22-23, it was increased by £2.7 million. And we're told here that's to help deliver strategic priorities. And these are listed, and one of them is enable enhanced public engagement and participation in committee work. And I'm just wondering, has this happened and how many staff have been allocated to that?
Who's going to do that? I know in general terms, obviously, we have actually filled many of the positions that we identified to you in the budget last year, but at the same time, we've seen vacancies arise in other areas of the Parliament. So we are not currently employing to full strength. But Sarah?
Yeah, I think that's right. So it was an additional 46 positions was what we bid for last year, a kind of net increase of 33 because some were already in temporary support. Right now, we've recruited 40 of those, but that's taken a period of time over the course of this year. So we've had vacancies in those positions throughout the course of the year. In terms of the kind of allocation of those, there were 21 in the scrutiny group, and that's really where, when we're talking about the benefits that you described there, that's where the bulk of the efforts were to be made.
In the post-Brexit constitutional arrangements, you mean?
That was part of it, but also the pact, so the teams that support engagement and bringing more committee, more participation to committees is also resourced in that team as well. So there were, I think there were three dedicated posts gone into PACT, which have been recruited in the current year.
And, what developments do you envisage from that in terms of what the enhanced public engagement?
Sorry, I missed that, Kavina.
Sorry, what developments do you expect from that to enhance public engagement? If you're employing three staff to enhance public engagement, what kind of improvements in public engagement do you envisage?
Well, as you may be aware, and I wearing a different hat as convener of the Citizens Engagement and Public Petitions Committee, we have been challenged as the lead committee taking forward the whole question of deliberative democracy. We have held an inquiry during the course of 2022. We produced an interim report with 17 recommendations which are now themselves out to consultation and for discussion with the government, which would lead to a very considerable change actually in the whole way in which Parliament engages more widely with the public and indeed the way the public engages with Parliament. And probably if some of these recommendations were to be accepted, would lead to some of, I think, the biggest changes in our interface and the involvement of the public since the advent of the Parliament. So that committee has seen a considerable amount of work done, including an inquiry that saw about 400 or 500 responses. It also set up a citizens panel, if you like, who were here on a residential basis for two weekends, and through a series of other meetings, meeting officials, MSPs and others, which led to the 17 recommendations. So I have always been intrigued. This panel and the whole question of citizens' engagement, public engagement, arose from the former Presiding Officer's Commission on Parliamentary Reform, was accepted by Parliament in the previous session, and in this session, allowing for the delays that arose as a consequence of the pandemic, has now started to take forward its work. I will be interested, as members who I think engage with the idea of public participation, come face to face with the recommendations that arise as a consequence, as do will government, as to whether the enthusiasm for all of this follows through into the practical responses of all those that will have to cede some of their own power or time, in fact, in order to make it work. But I'm optimistic.
Okay. I mean, I have to say there's been a lot of very positive comments about the work that you're actually doing there, Jackson. But obviously I was asking the question because I think I'm, again, trying to get things on a public record about where this money's been allocated. I mean, I take it there's a... Is there going to be a reduction in terms of the scrutiny over Brexit? I mean, we're now, you know, what, 3 years into it? I mean, surely there must be a kind of a change now in terms of the scrutiny. Sure, is it all winding up or is there more work to still to be done? Is it on the same level? Where are we with that?
That's probably the most loaded, explosive question that's going to be posed in Britain today, if I might say, convener. Is Brexit winding up? I mean, what, David, I mean, do you have a view as to whether this will be an ongoing concern or not?
It will very much be an ongoing concern. Obviously not Brexit itself, which clearly has happened, but the post-EU landscape is... it means that the Parliament's scrutiny of that landscape is much more complex and much more difficult than it was previously. And there are many different aspects to that. There's the relationships between the governments, the relationships between the parliaments, the interaction of things like the keeping peace powers in the Scottish Parliament, and all sorts of different layers that didn't exist before Brexit happened. So the resources that we bid for were very much about the longer term. They weren't transitional resources.
So she goes, in other words, basically. And then software support and licences, £2.213 million. What's the kind of split there again between the actual software support and licences?
Michelle?
So one of the things that we're doing is moving, and we've been talking to the committee for a few years now about moving towards more cloud-based infrastructure applications, and there's benefits to that. We'll see less of this kind of spiky investment as we're having to reinvest in infrastructure and also maintenance costs as well, because it's a rental model, you pay as you go for the cloud-based service. They offer us a lot of resiliency as well. So I think what the committee is starting to see now is a general reduction in our infrastructure type costs, but we'll see more around the kind of licensing costs with the cloud. We do still have, though, some infrastructure which is on site in the Scottish Parliament. We also have a physical disaster recovery facility, and one of the projects which is featured in the budgets for this year is looking at the feasibility of moving, how do we move entirely to a cloud-based system of disaster recovery should anything happen to the systems at Holyrood.
Okay, I was just looking to see how they could be split up. Again, it was like the contractors and permanent staff thing. I just think I'm looking to see where the money's going more directly.
Sorry, we've not got an analysis. I can come back to you on the split if you like. We haven't got a split in the budget at the moment.
That'd be great. And I'm just going to ask a question one other area, because I don't think my colleagues around the table will be queuing up to ask it, you know. And it's basically about the MSP salary issue. Funnily enough, interestingly, I noticed that an MSP pay, we talk about the 1.5% increase. I'll go back to that in a second. But in terms of the figures, it goes from 13.482 million to 13.499 million. And I couldn't really understand that, because a 1.5% increase would have been, off the top of my head, £190,000 or whatever. That's only 17,000 increase. So there are a couple of folk going to go on extended unpaid leave that we don't know about. I'm just wondering why that, how we come to those figures.
Very technical. Sarah?
Yes, so there are other drivers of the change in there. Part of it is we had assumed that increase in the national insurance rate. You'll remember that was announced and then changed. So that comes out. And also, when we put the budget together last year, we had assumed two additional cabinet secretary positions, which were that was more than was needed. So that's come out in the current year, and it has the roll-on effect into next year's budget as well. So that explains. So there's essentially three drivers rather than just the headline increase on the salary rate for MSPs. There are those two other things which take it down. That explain. I have a reconciliation if you need
Okay, that's a sound explanation. I should have thought of the National Insurance thing, because you do actually mention it in the document in terms of the overall budget. So thanks very much for explaining that. But the thing, of course, I'm going to ask you about is an annual survey of hours and earnings, the ASH index. I mean, I'm just wondering how, given that the GDP deflator is 3.2% and then CPI inflation is 10-11%, how is this arrived at? I mean, you talk as if, I take it as based on, it's about a year out of date, is that right?
It follows behind, yes, because it is a reflector of what has been happening to public sector pay in the period behind, not the period ahead.
What's the point in that, actually, when no other, you're not going to say to any other group of workers anywhere, including in this Parliament, that we're just going to actually look at the inflation rate as it was in late 2021 or whatever like that. So I'm just wondering how this is actually calculated and why it's been adopted, and I mean, who's consulted on that. And it does seem a bit of an anomaly that what you've said is based on the recent ASH publication. With regard to staff, this would amount to an index of 4.1%, but recognising current inflation figures, the SPCB has opted to use only the AWE index of 5.6% in order to uplift the general provision for members. So why is that not being used for MSPs if it's been used for everybody else? You said there was no virtue signalling, but there clearly is. And I'll just add one other point. If the ASH index says that because inflation was 10-11%, next year inflation might be, I don't know, 3 or 4% by this time next year, possibly even lower, and then MSPs get a 5% pay rise, whatever, or 3% or 4%. All you're going to do is end up with loads of headlines about inflation bust and pay rises, which by that time no one else will be getting in the public sector. It just seems to me daft from a PR point of view and from a practical point of view, from any point of view.
These are obviously issues, convener, which the corporate body does reflect upon. First of all, just to be clear, ASH lags because the data is gathered in April each year for the preceding year and is then published in October, November. So there's a 6-month difference between the data sets for these two indices. When we broke from Westminster in 2016, it was by a resolution of the Parliament that we adopted the ASH index. It's not a whim of the corporate body. So it is a decision of MSPs collectively in Parliament. Had, in fact, we not refused our increase in 2021-22 as a consequence of the pandemic, which was a 5.1% ASH index, which the Parliament declined to take, we would still today, I think, be ahead of where we would have been had we, throughout this prevailing period since 2016, applied CPI as the basis of our increase. I feel very firmly that there is an independent element to the setting of MSP pay. If the corporate body was simply on an annual basis to say, oh dear, doesn't look like we're getting much this year, which other indices that are around that we could adopt that would give us a better hike? I think that the opprobrium that would fall on us and the Parliament, who subsequently in approving the budget would be approving that increase, would be huge. I argued within the corporate body as the lead on finance that we stick with the ASH index long before I knew what it was even going to be. And I said that that may in fact mean that in the following financial year, we will have a higher increase, which we will then have to recommend as well. But in doing so, we are doing so in accordance with the decision by the Parliament to devolve the increase to the ASH index on an annual basis, thereby leaving a degree of independence between any suggestion that we as politicians are setting our own pay and not deferring to that different index. Might we change the index? Might we go to the Parliament to recommend a change? I'm not against potentially considering that, But I have to say, I would want to recommend that in a year where there was no material advantage to MSPs as a consequence. I really think to go to the Parliament and say, we would like to suggest we change the index this year because it'll give you a much bigger increase, would be irresponsible and unsupportable. Having said all that, and finally, the responsibilities of MSPs have changed since 2016. Following the Smith Commission, we have had additional responsibility transferred to the Parliament. And so I think it is potentially, therefore, worthwhile considering whether once a Parliament or once every two Parliaments, there is some independent review of where MSP sits in the wider context of public sector pay and whether it remains appropriate. But again, were that review to take place, it is my opinion that it should be a legacy recommendation from this Parliament to the next Parliament and not a recommendation by us which would benefit us in this present session, because I think there would be very little public support for that.
Well, first of all, I have to agree with everything you've actually said. I think what's important is that there's been an explanation on that. I still think, though, a system which is a year behind, whether you benefit or you don't benefit, is just odd, because it isn't reflected anywhere else in the public sector. And I don't think anyone in this committee would be suggesting, you know, that at a time when everybody else is taking below inflation pay rises, we don't do the same. But and it has to be independent. The reason I'm asking this, of course, is because other MSP colleagues will talk about it privately, but they'll know actually what to say it publicly. And that, of course, is itself an issue, frankly, because, you know, everybody else feels more than happy to talk about their paying conditions, regardless of where they work. So I think that explanation is really important. I think it's really helpful. I would have thought, though, that I just think the weakness with ASH is not that it's an independent system or anything like that. It's just it doesn't take into account the actual situation as we are, whether it's good, bad or indifferent. And I think all that will happen is, as I mentioned earlier, is in years where, because it's a year behind, it just looks bad when it's actually above CPI, you know, just as it looks odd when it's below CPI. It's just a rather bizarre system.
I fully accept the points that you make, convener. I think obviously what makes this acute at the moment is the prevailing inflation, which has made this increase this year stand out in the way it has. In many respects, I mean, it is responsible. I should say that ASH in Wales has delivered a 7.3% increase. So the indices produce different results in different jurisdictions, although in Wales, where they adopt ASH, they also have it capped at an annual increase of 3%. So the corporate body is mindful of these things. I think that it would have been, as I say, wrong and irresponsible for us to have adopted a different methodology this year. As I say, we agreed to stick with the methodology prior to knowing or having any idea what it was going to even suggest, which I think maintains the integrity of the process and discussion that we, as your MSP colleagues, have on the corporate body. But I've tried to set in context where we might look to in the future, but mindful of the fact that that shouldn't at any time be something that can be presented as any of us seeking to, if you like, take advantage of the opportunity that might exist were we to abandon the resolution that we made in 2016 and simply start to adopt another methodology. Whatever, by the way, convener, I think it must be a methodology. I think simply to say to the corporate body that they should put a finger in the wind and have a guess at what we should be paying ourselves each year would be completely the wrong thing. So I understand the point you're making. Is it the correct methodology? Should we review that methodology? As I say, I think that's something we would be prepared to do, but in a year where it was not going to make any material difference to the outcome, so that, again, MSPs could not be pointed at and accused of seeking to feather their own nest at the public expense.
I don't think it's about that at all. It's about having something which seems to be, you know, fair and realistic, etc., etc. And I think methodology is important. And I think the Welsh comparison is an interesting one if you look at the difference between the salaries that MAs were paid 20 years ago relative to MSPs and now. They were about 17,000 less per capita then, and I think they're higher now, and they're increasing from 60 to 96. So I think the Welsh thing is interesting. Of course, I raised it last year, that the corporate body completely ignores the different workload between list and constituency members. Completely ignores that. both in terms of the allocation for staff and salary. And every one person knows, and I was a list member, as were you, that the workload, there's no comparison, but everyone gets paid the same with the same salary. I know that's going to be something you're going to continue to ignore year in, year out, but if there is a reassessment, then that has to be the situation. It doesn't mean that the salary overall has to increase, but there should perhaps be a readjustment. I know I'm going to make myself extremely popular with three of my colleagues around the table for saying that, but that's a fact.
If I might borrow the phrase, you might think that, convener, I couldn't possibly comment.
Yes, indeed, indeed, absolutely. Okay, I've taken up more than enough time, we've got more questions, but I think it's time to let others in, and Liz will be first to fall by Daniel.
Thank you for that, and can I just acknowledge that I do very much agree with the previous conversation. I think it would be irresponsible if we were seen to be feathering our own nests. Can I just return, however, to the issue about commissioners, because I think it's absolutely vital that the public has complete transparency on exactly what their money is being used for. You mentioned in your note to us that the additional money that is being sought by the Commissioner for Human Rights is one of a reorganisation in staffing structure, whereas the one for the Ethics Commissioner is about additional staff, 7.4 equivalents. Do we have greater information about exactly what the new structure is for the Human Rights Commissioner, and do we know what the 7.4 full-time equivalents are actually going to be doing?
The answer to both those questions is yes. We have a very detailed operational organisational chart which has been submitted to us by each of the commissioners that present their requests and funding requirements to us. I don't have that structure in front of me just now, but if it would be helpful, that's, I think, perfectly possible for us to supply that.
It certainly is, and just to build on what Jackson has said there, the increase in staffing at the Ethical Standards Commissioner was based on a very thorough business case that was produced, and that itself was one of the recommendations that came out of the audit process this time last year, which identified governance failings, but very serious concerns with capacity and capability in the office as well. So the auditors had recommended that a workforce planning exercise be undertaken. That resulted in a business case which was presented to the corporate body. The corporate body interrogated that, including taking evidence on it from the acting commissioner. And that was all about getting the organisation back to where it needed to be in terms of its the role it plays in the ethics framework in Scotland.
Can I just ask on that point, I mean, is the fact that they're requiring 7.4 additional full-time equivalent staff, is that because the workload has significantly increased in the Commissioner's office? And if that is the case, do we know by how much that workload has increased? Because, again, I think that's a matter of public record. I mean, one of the things that I think is important about commissioners is that there is public accountability for where that money is being spent, and probably that's the commissioner that has the highest profile in terms of being held to the account by the public. So could you give us just a little bit more detail about that?
We certainly have all of that information. I don't have it with me today, but I can share that with the committee, and I think the commissioner also included it in his annual report. But there is quite a lot of detail there about the increase in the numbers of complaints, but also about the complexity of the complaints, and that was another factor in the workforce planning exercise, not just ensuring that they had the numbers of staff to process that, but that staff capability to manage that increased complexity in the complaints that we're dealing with. But that's information that I'd be more than happy to share with the committee.
I think it's also fair to say that the numbers did increase very significantly, and peaked as a result of many complaints that were received in respect of one very public matter. They have tailed off again slightly, but are still at a higher level than they previously were. But it is also that issue of complexity, which I think is something which has just evolved over time as the nature of complaints has become more detailed.
Okay, and just my final point, when it comes to the restructuring of the Human Rights Commission office, what does that restructuring actually involve?
Do we have anyone here? I don't know, do any of us? I think we'd have to come back to you indeed. I mean, it was, I can in my head remember the discussion, Ms. Smith, but I can't actually remember what the individuals would do, but the organisational approved chart we can certainly, operational structure we can supply. Because in this instance, as I say, there were requests for significantly more people than we eventually agreed to employ.
I think, Convener, if it's all right with you, that I think some of that additional information is quite important for just getting on the public record. If Mr Carlow could produce that in due course, that would be fine. Thank you.
OK, thank you. Daniel, to be followed by John.
Thank you, Convener. Can I commend Mr Carlow on prefiguring the exact topic I was going to ask questions on? And can I just say, having installed a smart meter in my house over Christmas, I do consider this an area of my expertise in addition to retail. But can I ask, I mean, the £4 million figure, and I can well understand that you need a robust system to manage the heat, ventilation and so on, but it does strike me as being a very large sum. Can I ask what that will actually buy the Parliament? Is that just software, or is that new infrastructure? You know, in particular, you know, I would have thought if this is our 20-year-old system that we're replacing, that these days these things sit on the network rather than requiring their own dedicated wire. I mean, could you just explain a little bit why £4 million for any single item of software, if that's what it is, would be a large amount. Could you just explain how that...
I mean, I'm sure there'll be colleagues, but can I just introduce it by saying obsolescence is just a reality in terms of plant. And on my tour of the bowels of the building, I mean, it is like visiting the Britannia or the Queen Mary. I mean, what you will see if you take up the offer is quite extraordinary. I didn't realise that we went quite so far down, or that we sit on a lake and all we pump up water from a historical lake, which in fact flushes all the toilets in the building. But clearly, as we seek to meet our environmental obligations, the nature of the way in which the building and this room that we sit in just now in every aspect operates is critical. It's not like a domestic situation where I suppose we can wait until the boiler fails and then shiver for a fortnight and have someone come along and do something about it. We simply obviously have to have a plan which ensures that this Parliament will always be functioning and operational. As I say, the corporate body would be very happy to facilitate, and I know this isn't necessarily what you were looking for, but in your newfound expertise, you might find it revealing, a tour of all of this, provided the convener resists the temptation of some of the colleagues in the corporate body to press the big red button that says "do not press." But it is revealing. I mean, because to someone like me who has no understanding of these issues, when you see the extent of all of this, it's way beyond anything I imagined. But this is a very carefully established four-year programme. Michelle, do you want to just talk more generally about that?
Yes.
I think it's working automatically.
So to answer your question, it is a mixture of infrastructure and software. And I guess one of the things that helped explain it to me, because it is a quite complex and technical project, I guess it's something, as Mr Carlow has alluded to, is very much about even sitting in this room, the comfort of sitting in this room. It's the ventilation, it's the air conditioning, it's the heating, the cooling. But it's not just the building, it's also carrying out an essential function in actually cooling our communications servers, which are broadcast security and IT, which, as you'll appreciate, need to be kept at certain temperature and certain levels of humidity in order to be able to function in the building.
So, I mean, I understand
so
the purpose.
Both of those things.
It is more just of the split. And in particular, given that half of that is being spent, it's a four-year project, but half of it is being spent in this coming year, just understanding that split between what is going to be essentially the cost of the work being done, cost of software, cost of infrastructure, would just be helpful just to get an understanding of the split.
Yeah, and we can come back to you on the detailed breakdown then if that would be helpful. But the procurement phase will commence imminently. We would expect by the time we get into the summer of this year, we will be in a position to be deciding on whether, with the corporate body, whether to award a contract to proceed. And then, as you'll see, we have a range of costs at the moment until we go out to the market, and then we will have a much firmer schedule in terms of how much it's specifically going to cost and the sequencing of the work. So we've worked up a programme for it at the moment, but until we go to the market and we have the specialists who tell us how they're going to install it, that will be subject to change, but it will become firmer once we get into the summer and we know what the market has returned by way of the investment, because we need specialists to install it in the Parliament.
So, I mean, obviously this is important because it fundamentally controls the utilities bill that the Parliament receives, which is budgeted to be 1.46 million. Can I ask two questions? So, you know, given first of all, what will the lifespan of this system be? So if it's £4 million, I think we can understand if the system's going to last 5 years, that would raise an eyebrow. If it's for another 20 years to manage, you know, 1.5 million to spend, that makes sense. So what's the lifespan? Also, what's the split of that utilities bill between essentially the environmental and all other utilities requirements?
Okay, I'll try my best to answer. In terms of, to give you a sense of, obviously we're looking for maximum life expectancy out of a new system. This one's been in place 20 years. We've eked it out, maintained it with the one supplier, which is obviously a disadvantage. We want a system that is capable of being maintained by more than one supplier. And it'll also be a more modern, resilient system. So in terms of what we need to do to reach net zero, we're going to have to make further investments, and they need to be able to interface with a more modern building energy management system so that we can get the data in terms of where we're using our gas and electricity, how we might tweak and amend that, how we might reduce consumption, and also to be able to set us up for the longer term changes around net zero, where we have to reduce our gas reliance on gas. We have to move to a different way of heating, perhaps through heat pumps, but we also have to be prepared for the greening of the grid, which is going to bring us the biggest benefits in terms of reduction of our electricity. So this system, there's two rationales behind it, if you like. One is its obsolescence, and it has to be replaced. It's 20 years old. It's been in here since 2003-04. It's now a huge risk in terms of business critical system running the building. But the other thing is the huge advantage in terms of our journey to net zero and the other work that we will become to speak to the committee about in probably the next time we're in front of you, about the investment we need to make over the longer term to reach net zero, and indeed the interim target that we have to reduce emissions by 66% by the end of this session.
Minimum split between gas and electricity.
So I don't have the specific... Okay. Do you want... We can give you our current split in terms of gas and electricity.
That's the question I'm asking.
Right.
Yeah, so of the 1.4 million, the bulk of it's electricity, so more than 900,000 in electricity.
Electricity.
Yeah.
My final question is this. Is how safe is that 1.46 billion budget? Because that's a 40%, a 39% increase. But currently, if you look at wholesale gas and electricity prices, they're sitting at almost five times higher than they were this time a year ago. So have you already bought the gas and electricity for the coming year? And is that safe? But do we then need to anticipate a quite significantly larger increase in next year's budget if this 1.46 has already been contracted for?
I can answer this. Yes, so we have bought about 84% of next year's supply for both gas and electricity. Those contracts were just signed in this final quarter, so they come into effect for the tail end of this year. So we will have an overspend in the current financial year of about £150,000-£160,000. And then, as I say, we've got 84% contracted for the budget year that we're essentially discussing just now. We benefit from the Scottish Government frameworks. We're part of the arrangements with them. That's where the pricing is secured through that. So, yeah, I mean, I guess it's hard to know what utility prices are going to do by the time we get to, we're talking about, yeah, probably at least later than this time next year. The information coming out of the OBR is that they actually anticipate that utilities pricing will, by 2024, start decreasing. So, yeah, it's hard to anticipate. But I guess the confidence you can have in the numbers that we've got is that 84% is purchased for that upcoming period.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. John, followed by Michelle.
Thanks very much, convener. As I understand it, you're looking for a 4.8% cash increase this year. Now, some parts of the public sector have been given a flat cash settlement. If the Parliament was to say to you there's a flat cash settlement, what would that mean in practice?
Michelle?
So, there would be, we've talked about a degree of risk-based assumptions in putting the budget together, and I think Sarah has just indicated one of them, which is that, yes, we've tried to reduce the risk on utilities, but obviously there's still an element of risk there, which we are going to have to meet within our budgets. It would mean that probably something like the Building Energy Management System would be something that we might not be able to progress. Certainly, we'd have to go back and look at all of our project spend again. And in terms of our project spend, you know, a significant amount of that, if you look at both the Building Energy Management System and the Chamber Conferencing, these are business critical systems that are obsolescence. So we do have a variety of other investments which are about maintaining the building, keeping it wind and watertight, etc. I think it would, given that the bulk of our budget is obviously across members, their staff, Parliament staff and office holders made up of salaried budgets, that would place a huge pressure on the Parliament to be able to meet increase in progression and or salary cost of living awards as well.
Mm-hmm. No, I mean, I do understand that. I'm not really arguing with that, but I just suppose other parts of the public sector are under that kind of pressure. Commissioners, we have discussed at quite some length, but I mean, just for clarity, who do you think should be taking, is it this committee, do you think should be taking an overview of commissioners? Because you've made the point it's not, and I accept it's not the corporate body's responsibility to say no. And all the individual commissioners, I'm sure, are doing and will do good work. But somebody needs to look at the overall picture and say, well, this is money that is not going into frontline services. This is money that's going into commissioners. Who should be taking that overall picture, do you think?
Well, I mean, it's twofold. I mean, I don't know if David will have a different view, but I would have said it's for Parliament itself, it's for the committees of this Parliament, and perhaps the fact of all of this needs to be something which this committee shares with other committees in terms of the concerns and consequences. And secondly, it's for the Scottish Government as well, because the Scottish Government is also an advocate for the establishment and creation of a number of commissioners. I've certainly noticed that there has been an increase in the number of my parliamentary colleagues who have identified the opportunity to progress a bill for a commissioner. I do think Parliament should be interrogating all of these carefully, in my own view, and this is a personal opinion. From time to time, I think we then devolve responsibility and accountability by talking about the creation of a commissioner, which at the moment rests elsewhere and potentially undermines this Parliament's ability to interrogate and pursue that direct accountability. But it's not, and that's a personal comment, not one on behalf of the corporate body. But I do think it is, and I identified to you all the potential additional commissioners. And when I said when this Parliament established that we had two, the fact that we could be looking at having 14 is a very considerable increase in something which I think in my first Parliament in 2007-11, a hybrid committee was established, or certainly a committee on which I sat, was established because the Parliament took the view that there were too many commissioners then and that there needed to be a rationalisation. And indeed, I believe we did reduce slightly, but it became very difficult to put any genie back in the bottle because the outside interest in the work of any commissioner once established leads to a very considerable campaign on that commissioner's behalf. If there's any suggestion that there might be some way to merge their work with another commission. And frankly, back in the 2007-11 Parliament, MSPs balked at the recommendations And in fact, the number of commissioners was maintained at a higher level than was being recommended by the committee that had looked at the potential consolidation. So I think it's a complicated process, but I do think we are moving into a period where it is becoming altogether regarded as a casual thing to suggest, do and implement the establishment of another commissioner. And it's an expensive extension of our public sector.
I think I personally do share some of your concerns, and I think maybe the committee can look at this at some point as an overall picture.
When he just looks at me like that with that appeal,
I don't make many suggestions. Moving on, the contingency increase from 1 million to 1.5 million, now is that really just to cover in case inflation hits a particular bit harder than we're expecting?
Yes. I think it is the case that as a consequence of inflation, this year we ended up utilising most of the contingency that we had in the previous financial year. In years prior to that, I think we've used less of the contingency in a number of years, and it struck the corporate body as sensible just to have that additional provision by way of contingency in the budget for next year, given that there are certain factors that we simply about which we simply cannot be sure.
And is one of these factors pay? Because there were various figures in the papers, like 6.7% was mentioned, but I think that's kind of overall figure. And I saw the cleaning budget was only going up 3.9%, which presumably we're giving, or we would be giving the cleaners a bit more than 3.9%. So can you say, you may be negotiating, I don't know, so I don't know what you can say in public, but can you give us any indication about pay increases next year?
I would hope you would understand why we would think it probably best that we don't explore that area this morning. Clearly, there are negotiations which are now underway, and I think we would respect the integrity of that process.
I do accept that. I don't know if you can tell us anything, privately, or send us any private information about that, or at least keep us updated as it moves forward, because that, I assume, would have a major impact on the budget and in your contingency if you have to settle for slightly more than you're expecting, or even slightly less than you're expecting.
Well, contingency is there to meet the potential volatilities in inflation. I think it's important for me to say. I don't know if there's anything further you want to add, Michelle.
I mean, certainly in the current financial year, the pay settlement was above what we had budgeted, and we used about £500,000 of the current year's contingency to cover that that difference. So essentially the contingency is there to cover, I guess, risk across a number of categories, but a pay settlement would be one. I mean, in the salary increase, the salary cost increase, there's also the annualisation effect of the additional posts that were introduced in this current year, because they weren't all in place. They were not assumed to be in place from the start of the financial year. So there is a rollover impact, which is also reflected in that 6.7.
If I could just come in and add that, as Sarah alluded to, we had to use our contingency in the current financial year, but that was exceptional circumstances because, obviously, when we budgeted, inflation was an unknown quantity, and it was an exceptional quantity given the pay negotiations for the current year. In fact, the Parliament settled very early. I think our pay award was in May, well ahead of the rest of the public sector. And we would certainly be hoping with RTUS to begin negotiations early and to settle early so that people had their pay awards in their pockets early in the financial year. But the inflationary impacts are across all aspects of our running costs. So it's not just projects, for example, in terms of increased costs around cost of components, delays, access to specialist contractors, increased rates for specialist contractors, but it's also within some of our contracts and some of our licensing costs, which have got CPI and RPI built in as the means by which those are uprated. And then obviously other things to do with, for example, utilities, where there is a degree of exposure around inflation as well. So I'd just like to highlight it's across all aspects of our running costs, and that's why the contingency has been increased to 1.5, which we will, as we always do, be very circumspect in how we use contingency, aware of the wider pressures in the public sector.
Okay, that's helpful. Thank you. Another point, if I'm understanding it correctly, the uptake by MSPs of the staff allowance, I think you were assuming it was 95%, you're now assuming it's 93%. Can you just maybe give me a wee bit of explanation around that?
Sure, Sarah can, but that has been our experience. We have been clearly, obviously, in the first year of the Parliament, it takes some time for MSPs to come to a view as to the staffing requirement that they will require, and we can see that evolving. And so, obviously, we anticipate a lower uptake in the first year, but it seems we can now consistently identify that the uptake in terms of overall MSP staff is at a level where we can safely budget at 93%.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's right. We've looked at the years, 6 or 7 years history, excluding the election period, because we know that that's always different from a normal running year. And we've concluded that it was reasonable to budget and appropriate, given the context, to budget at that 93% instead of at 95% uptake.
That's positive. I mean, I think MSPs, it's good if they keep thinking that if we save a bit of money in our staffing budgets, it puts money into the NHS or wherever else.
But that's an average, of course.
Yes, no, except that, yes. Because some people will go to 100%, I take it. Yeah. And my final point then, I mean, as far as actually saving money is concerned, can you give us any idea of practical things that we might be doing? Are we cutting the temperature in this building, for example?
Michelle, do you want to talk to that?
Yeah, so in terms of efficiency, you've obviously just touched on one. We've been looking very keenly at the budget, and the remodelling of the uptake is one aspect, which is saving about, I think it's about 400,000 on the budget that we're putting forward for next year. Procurement is another big area where we are able to track savings. We quite frequently, or we try as much as we can, to use the collaborative frameworks, which means we've got the sort of aggregate bulk of the public sector to pay. And we saved in 21-22, using Scottish Procurement Zone analysis, over £500,000 in terms of using these collaborative frameworks to procure goods and services for the Parliament. Even where we didn't use that, it was around £400,000 saving in that financial year, also through how we procured and got value through procurement as well. We're also looking at trying to bear down on contracts and costs. So, for example, one of the things that we have done in the current year is renegotiated the Microsoft license, enterprise license, which is about £70,000 recurring annual saving to the Parliament. We've also managed to reduce some of our cloud hosting costs, which is another £40,000, which we've managed to save in the budget we're putting forward. And we are currently concluding a project around our telephony, and one of the things we will be doing through that is reducing our telephony costs as well, as we move towards a new system, a cloud-based system of telephony in the current financial year. The other thing that we do, and which you'll see in our project budget, which we have kept to in terms of the indicative, is that we prioritise our project spend quite closely, taking a risk-based approach on the things which are red and we actually have to address project spend on, versus the things which we can maybe eke out or push out and keep going for a bit longer, so that we're able to kind of maintain a five-year project pipeline, which we don't see big spikes in investment. We try and keep it relatively stable. So those are some of the ways in which we try and introduce efficiency. We've also got, as part of our strategic plan, an entire programme of work, which Sarah is leading, around operational excellence, which is looking at how we automate, how we introduce AI, clever interrogation of data, to be able to actually improve efficiency in how we as a staffing group actually undertake our work and the services that we provide to members as well.
So, thank you. Thanks.
Good news, there's no new website on the way.
One of the pleasures of being in the corporate body is that the MSPs who sit on it get to meet and work with many of the officials of the Parliament who are otherwise unknown. Michelle there was making reference to procurement. Veronique Malcolm, who is responsible for procurement in the Parliament, is passionate and reports to the corporate body in a very detailed way and is incredibly proud, I think, of the savings that we are able to achieve as a result of the focus that she brings to our procurement within the Parliament. So there are, you know, I'm always amazed, really, having been an MSP not on the corporate body, how much of the infrastructure of this Parliament is in the hands of people that MSPs really know nothing about, but who really do a terrific job on our behalf.
Thanks very much for that. Michelle, to follow by Douglas.
Good morning, and thank you for attending today. And I definitely echo and reflect the comments you've just made, Jackson, about the staff. I think the operation of the Parliament is a huge undertaking, and many people don't appreciate that. I'll happily take up a tour of the basement, and I promise to press no red buttons either. The first thing I want to ask is actually slightly to take unusually issue with the convener in going back to Brexit. I mean, if I were in a similar position to you, the FTE equivalents required for forthcoming work for Brexit would certainly need to be given careful consideration. I know from anecdotal chats with clerks that the number of LCMs and the complexity and scrutiny over the course of this year has been quite considerable. And when I mention retained EU law and the kind of back-ending scrutiny of that and then into the year after, to be honest, it's usually greeted by horror by the clerks I've spoken to, such as the extent of the unknown. So my question to you is, I'm not certain about what specific additional headcount provision you've made for Brexit in the light of retained EU law that could see circa 4,000 pieces of legislation folding. I'm sure it won't come to that, but it's certainly considerable. So what's the specific headcount and how confident are you in the provision of that headcount?
David?
We'll be keeping it under regular review, but at the moment I'm relatively confident, and the reason for that is that the increase in the headcount that we promoted, and we were grateful for the committee's support and all of that, was based on very robust business cases that came through from all of the individual parts of the organisation that were going to be affected by changes in the constitutional position in the country. And there was lots of analysis of what the future might look there. So I think we referred earlier to the fact that there were 46 additional posts, including translating those that were temporary posts into permanent posts. Almost half of them were in the scrutiny function alone, but an additional 8, I think, from memory, were in our legal services department, because they are impacted hugely by the complexity and the retained EU law proposed changes there will have a massive impact on our legal colleagues as well. So they'll be looking over the course of this year at the impact that might have on them, whether those additional resources are going to be enough. I'm sure they're going to have to marshal them to that absolute limit, even if that is going to be enough, or whether there's going to be some sort of transitional element required in terms of temporary resources to get us through that process of retained EU law as currently proposed.
Michelle, it looked like you perhaps wanted to add something at the start of there just to... Okay. Right, so you're feeling confident, and I'm sure that would be something that we scrutinise. And the other thing I wanted to pick up on, I mean, you're probably pleased at the outing this morning, Jackson, in that we're not talking about the IT system, and I did feel more than a little sympathy for you last time, because you're accountable as compared to responsible for the operation of this huge outfit. So, but I suppose two questions. It's come to my attention, and you're probably aware that this committee under our public administration is going to be looking at decision making within the Scottish Government as a kind of discipline in of itself. And I've seen examples recently where decisions have been made on a risk assessed basis that looked at probability of an adverse outcome, but only looked at the impact on one key stakeholder grouping, for example. And that's an obvious example. So I suppose what I wanted to explore with you, Jackson, given the fact that you're accountable and there's clearly very professional staff in place, how do you assess yourself in that accountable position, that the decision making is as robust as it can be? Because I appreciate you're quite exposed and you're doing a very good job on behalf of all parliamentarians, but you're quite exposed. So how do you assess that risk to yourself? Because it's, you get it in the neck if things go slightly awry.
I honestly don't know that I do dwell on that aspect of the responsibility in terms of the risk to ourselves. I mean, what I am satisfied by, and I think what it's important to say the corporate body requests or requires, is all the information that we think we require in order to be satisfied that the correct decisions are being made and taken. And from time to time, that does mean that items get deferred on the agenda of the corporate body because we feel more information is required around the decisions that are being thought about, progressed or taken. Clearly, the multi-parliamentary extended nature of the IT contract and the kind of slight weaknesses that that exposed to us, which I think we've adjusted our own internal systems to reflect. David, can you, I mean, we have done some things differently as a consequence of that. That exposed one, it was one illustration of something that exposed a weakness. But in general terms, for example, John Mace was talking about procurement a moment ago. The reports that we get and the opportunity we have to interface with the team, Veronique and others responsible for that, do satisfy us that we are on the correct path and the correct decisions are being arrived at. David?
Yeah, I would back up that entirely. I mean, the governance process here is that the corporate body delegates to me the day-to-day running of the organisation, and I further delegate that to Michelle and people like Sarah. And it then becomes a matter of judgment on my part as to what is escalated to the corporate body and in what form. And the kind of examples that Jackson has given there have been examples where the corporate body has said, we need more information on this, or we need this type of issue, like the major projects, to be done a bit differently. They need more information from me and my colleagues when they're overseeing that. And as you put it, their necks are on the line. Ultimately, the responsibility for that lies with me, but the ultimate accountability is the corporate body. So that's how the relationship works between the staff and the corporate body in general terms.
Yeah, and I utterly appreciate and understand that based on my kind of previous career. You're describing a norm that I would expect to see in place. So I suppose what I'm probing, the risk of doing that is that where you have collaborative bodies who are working well together and people are generally nice and get on well together, it actually introduces a risk of groupthink, where insufficient challenge creeps in over a period of time, just because people are nice and they believe each side is doing a professional body and a piece of work, and why wouldn't you? So I suppose what I'm trying to explore, and it may well come up again in our decision-making inquiry, how robustly you ensure healthy tension, if you like, as a body, because it's absolutely necessary. And over time, that can diminish in any organisation. And actively putting that at the forefront, particularly you, Jackson, when you're accountable and you're next in the line.
Well, thank you for that. I mean, I'm sure Maggie Chapman, Claire Baker, Christine Graham and I will all be flattered to know that we are nice. I mean, that's... But I think if you were to... I mean, obviously, the corporate body is not a committee of the Parliament. The discussions we have are discussions which there is a published minute of, which gives some flavour of the outcome of the discussions we have. I don't think the officials would say, correct me if I'm wrong, that we sit there quietly or meekly and are shy to come forward with questions. I mean, some of the issues that you've discussed with me and colleagues this morning have equally been challenged by your colleagues on the corporate body in the progressing of the decisions that have finally been taken. So I don't know that... I think groupthink is something which you would not get in the Chamber of the Parliament amongst the same assortment of politicians. And actually, although we have an outcome to arrive at in the corporate body, there is a degree of challenge and different perspective brought to most of the discussions that we have.
Okay. My last question concerns disaggregation of data. It's a sort of thematic that I keep following, where I ask, do organisations, and that includes the SPCB, routinely disaggregate all data you collect by sex? Because we can't affect any change unless we have the data. And every time I've asked this question of everybody, I keep finding out, no, they don't routinely do that, and therefore how can you affect change to ensure parity? So, same question to you.
I'm conscious that there's a biannual item on the agenda which is very gender specific in terms of the way in which the Parliament functions. But I don't know, Michelle, is that you want
Sorry,
to add?
Do you mind if I just clarify? Do you mean in terms of feedback or, research?
Every measure where you're every data item where you're collecting data, do you have that routinely disaggregated? Because that follows into things like your procurement policy and so on. But only by collecting the data can you start that moving forward effect.
So there are things which are regularly collected, which are analysed by the kind of characteristics that you set out in terms of the staffing group of the organisation. We also collect a lot of data around parliamentary business, which can be diced and spliced in lots of different ways. And that is possible through that. Yes, SPICE can do that through that as well. I know that members sometimes ask for data sets to be provided on parliamentary data in that way, broken down that way, and that can be done. I'm not aware of anything else that specifically we are doing in this area, but I'm happy to take it away and come back to you if it's a particular area of interest.
I suppose my final question would be, if I said to you, is this a gender-friendly parliament in all facets, you would, of course, I assume, say yes. But I would then challenge you to say, well, how do you know?
There's visitor feedback, for example. That would be one of the things we point to. We also survey our witnesses who come in to give evidence to the parliament as well. We've got a range of facilities in place. We've a range of external advisory bodies, obviously, that also look at various things to do with our access in terms of disability, different genders. So there's various feedback that we routinely gather, if that's the kind of thing you're asking about, which gives us feedback on how inclusive we are. And obviously, inclusivity is actually one of the core values of the parliamentary staffing group as well. So we do pay a lot of attention to looking at diversity and inclusion, not just in our own operations, but also in our operations that we provide to the public, as well as obviously the services we're providing to members and their staffing groups.
I suppose what I'm asking is almost like turning it on its head. What you're describing is some collectors, some output, which, if you chose so to do, you could pull into one report or one facet. I suppose what I'm asking is, when was the last time you produced, or have you ever produced, a similar report to what you've done just now, or indeed in any area, where it was done entirely from the point of view of the female population in every single facet? And have you ever considered doing something like that?
Yes, there's a piece of work underway at the moment, which one of our colleagues is supporting the presiding officer on and a board on, around the gender sensitive audit. You may have heard of this work. So that, I believe they are at the point where they're about to agree their report and produce it. So that's one example where there's been something done very specifically in that context.
Yeah. Well, anyway, I'll leave it with you for something to think about. The opening question, do you routinely disaggregate every data collector by gender, is a valid question, because it flows through into like procurement. Do you know that you have equitability in your procurement to women-led businesses, for example? And that's an issue for many facets of the Parliament, as I'm coming across. OK, thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Douglas.
Thanks, Convener. Just want to say that I really welcome the major multi-year project section. I think it does really help us as a committee. And just on that, the building energy management system, I had one follow-up question from what Daniel was asking. And that was, I think you seemed to suggest, Michelle, that this would help us towards being a net zero parliament. So is this a spend to save? And do we have any idea how much of a reduction in our energy consumption this can lead to?
So it's two things. First of all, it's a replacement because it absolutely has to be replaced because it's going to fall over. And that then means that we would be in a risk position to be able to operate the parliament. So it has to be replaced. But then also there's benefits in replacing it because it'll be a more modern, resilient system, which means that the other investments that we need to make in terms of facilities management to be able to reach net zero are going to be able to interface smartly with the new building energy management system. Somebody explained it to me at the outset, and I think, and this was a good analogy, it stuck with me. When this was introduced, people were using Nokia phones. You cannot watch YouTube on a Nokia phone in 2003. So we're dealing with technology now that is at the very end of its life in terms of what it can smartly do to be able to monitor usage of electricity in the building and gas supply, and also adapt that as the footfall of the building adapts and how we use the building adapts as well, but also how other investments that we need to be thinking around investing in to meet net zero in the building are going to interface with it and plug into it, if you like. So yes, it will lead to that. What we don't have at the moment is the detail of how that's all going to work, because some of that is going to be dependent on the route map, the critical path to net zero. Now, that work is getting undertaken at the moment. Our expectation is by the time we get to the end of this financial year, we know what we need to do. It's the sequencing, it's the critical path, it's the investment. So we would expect by the time we get to the end of the current financial year, we will have that kind of roadmap to net zero. And then that will show us how we're going to meet those ultimate targets by 2038.
So is it not then a risk going ahead with this until you have that route map, so you know exactly what heat pumps we're going to require, what solar panels we're require, and how it's all going to interface together? It seems a bit strange that we're doing this one piece. Maybe it's, as you say, maybe really necessary because we've got an antiquated system just now. But would it not be safer to have the whole route map, the whole plan, before pushing ahead with this little bit?
It's not a little bit. No, this is an enabler. It's like a foundational piece. And we've had experts in supporting our facilities management team to actually scope it and then go out to the market. So I would expect to see as part of the specification, obviously, that it's got that ability as an enabler to make sure that whatever else we need to invest in later on is going to be compliant and be able to interface with it, which you would expect from modern technology at this point in time. I should say they've also been talking to other organisations who have undertaken a replacement of their built-in energy management system. In fact, in Edinburgh, I believe the Castle's already done it, to look at how others have found the experience and the sort of the interface, if you like, that is going to help work whenever they bolt on other places of future investment. But of course, we still have to, that's going to be many years. This is to 2038, the net zero path.
So when will we see that costs and that pathway then?
So we're hoping to have the route map, if you like, the critical path to net zero identified by the time we start to get into the end of this current financial year. And then there'll be estimates of what some of those cost packages will be. So that, I think, is something that we'll start to see come through in the next, well, obviously BEMS is part of the next 4 years, but then we'll start to see the other investments that we need to make as part of net zero as well. Okay. Some of that isn't entirely in our gift, obviously, but some of it around how we can reduce our own consumption is in our gift. But obviously things like the greening of the grid, anything we might do more collaboratively around heating the building, for example, is work that requires engagement with others as well.
Okay, one last question I had was there's 189,000 in for office space planning and moves in line with our new ways of working strategy. Can we have a bit more information of what that actually is?
Yes, you can. So post-pandemic, we've obviously been investing. Well, we've got a programme called New Ways of Working, which is for members and their staff and for our own staff around a more flexible hybrid way of working, so between Holyrood and elsewhere. So one of the things we are looking to do is amend the building accordingly. So we're going to be, obviously, we've got a lot of spaces which are not being routinely used all the time, which is inefficient. We're heating and lighting them, for example. So we're looking at trialling more collaborative spaces, which means that people don't have a set desk. This is not for all staff. We will be categorising the types of worker, but we will be introducing collaborative spaces so that people can put their stuff in a locker, choose to sit alongside other colleagues rather than do what they do now, which is go to an office, which has just tended to be their one office that their one team works in. And we'll also be introducing more flexible, we've been piloting booths that you can go into and make a hybrid call one-to-one with some confidentiality. So there's a variety of these kind of new ways of working and using the spaces in Holyrood that we're trialling as well. And the other big investment has been the digital meeting rooms. We'll have 30 of those by the end of the current financial year, which means that you can have your meeting in hybrid as well as all virtually as well as all physical.
It's not really a way of trying to get more people in the building, it's just a new way of working altogether. Okay, thank you. Thanks, Camino.
Yeah, sorry, we're all just chatting here about why does that cost £189,000, given the fact that all the facilities are already here, the offices are here, you know, the staff are here, the technology's here, the desks are here.
Well, not all of the technology and the facilities were here. For example, we didn't have all of the technology to be able to do the hybrid meetings. I think if you've been in the rooms that have been set up for that, you'll see that it's different technology, which kind of zones in on the person as they're speaking, and you've got, you know, we're still doing that at the moment. Yeah, that's work that's ongoing at the moment.
Way beyond committee rooms, this is
this is the entire building. So, and obviously there's a big pressure. Well, we were very aware at the outset when everybody started to come, well, not everybody, but when people started to resume coming back to Holyrood, that this ability to meet in a hybrid fashion was one of the early pressure points. So we took an early decision to invest in this technology in our meeting rooms. The other thing that we'll be doing in that space, which is part of that cost, is looking at a simple way of being able to book a hybrid room when you make a Teams meeting.
I'm tempted to ask a whole barrage of questions on this, but time is against us, and we have the Deputy First Minister waiting to ask a question on the budget. And I have to say, your answers have been very comprehensive to date. We've overrun our time quite significantly. So I just want to thank you for your contributions and members for their questions. And we'll just call a break to 11 o'clock to enable an exchange of witnesses. Thanks. now continue our evidence taking on the Scottish Budget 23-24, and I welcome to the meeting John Swinney, the Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for COVID Recovery. Mr Swinney is joined by Scottish Government officials Alison Cumming, Director of Budget and Public Spending, Gary Gillespie, Chief Economist, and Andrew Scott, Director of Tax and Revenues. We have around 90 minutes for this session, and before opening the discussion, I'd like to wish Mr Swinney and his colleagues Happy New Year and ask him if he'd like to make an opening statement.
Thank you very much, Convener, and a Happy New Year to you and to members of the committee and parliamentary staff. When I set out the budget in December, I indicated this was a particularly challenging budget to construct. We are managing a range of unprecedented circumstances due to volatility from global factors, the impact of inflation and the cost of living crisis, and the consequences of the September fiscal statement from the United Kingdom Government. We've taken difficult decisions across government through the emergency budget review in this financial year, totalling £1.2 billion in reductions in public expenditure, allowing us to meet the costs of increased public sector pay and provide further help to those most impacted by the cost of living crisis. I'm still working to ensure we can forge a path to balance in this year's budget and have applied the assumption that there will be no carryover of resources into next year's budget from this year. In developing my approach to the 23-24 Scottish Budget, I've taken the necessary steps to continue to maximise the Scottish Government's support for people in Scotland during the cost of living crisis. The pressures upon this budget cannot be overstated, and we've chosen to act to do everything in our power to deliver for the people of Scotland. We are confronting the challenges we face by increasing taxation for those most able to pay to enable additional investment to be made in the National Health Service at this critical time. This budget is choosing to invest in Scotland and focus on eliminating child poverty, prioritising a just transition to net zero and investing in our public services. I welcome the opportunity to meet with the committee this morning to discuss the budget in more detail and to assist the committee's scrutiny of the Scottish Budget.
Thank you very much for that opening statement. Now, obviously, over the next few weeks, we're going to have three debates. We'll have a debate with regard to a report on scrutiny, and then we'll have stage one and stage three in the chamber. So I think one of the important things, because we are going to end up having a tussle over this across the party divide, I believe, is to clarify the figures. So let's look where we are. At the very start of the 23-24 budget document, it set against inflation of 11.1%, and yet the Scottish Block Grant has declined by 4.8% in real terms over 2 years. However, that's using a GDP deflator of 3.2%, which you point out is the usual comparator for analysing real terms changes in public spending. As highlighted by the OBR and the Scottish Fiscal Commission, it doesn't really capture the realities faced by the public sector, whereas if the Consumer Price Index was used as a measure of inflation, it would show UK funding to be 10.8% lower than 2 years ago. However, although those are the figures in the document, when SPICE have looked at the same figures, they've said, and I quote, resources due to increase by 3.7% in real terms in 23-24 and capital to fall by 2.9% in real terms. So do we accept those figures, which appear superficially to be contradictory, or are these figures different because the balance has shifted between the block grant and the taxes being raised?
It's not for me to explore or explain the numbers from SPICE. I put forward the government's numbers and the government's assessment, and I think and we do that on a transparent basis, which indicates a number of points. First of all, the impact of inflation can be viewed and judged in a variety of different ways. If I recall correctly, when I was last at the committee asked me if I would be using the GDP deflator, and I indicated I would be because that was important for the sake of consistency in the way in which budget documentation is presented. Having said that, I think what the Office for Budget Responsibility and the Fiscal Commission have said to the committee is accurate, that the GDP deflator is a measure of comparative effect from year to year, but the effects of inflation will present themselves in a variety of different ways to different aspects of the public services and the public finances. So, although I present the numbers underpinned by the GDP deflator, I can't ignore the fact that the effect of inflation in reality, in terms of a term which might capture this better, the ability to spend or the capacity to spend is eroded by the effect of inflation. So in terms of the details on the numbers within the budget, I think what the budget documentation shows quite clearly is that there has been a real terms fall between 21-22 and 23-24 of 3.2% in the Barnett resource funding that the government has available to us. And obviously we've taken steps in the budget to try to address some of that that impact by the decisions that we've taken on tax, to try to overcome some of the effect of the erosion of our financial settlement, both in terms of the contents of that financial settlement and then the capacity to spend as a consequence of the effect of inflation.
Done that, there'd be very severe impacts on the budget.
Well, of course, Convener. As a consequence of the decisions taken on tax alone, there is £519 million available to be spent within the Scottish public finances that would not have been there had we not taken those decisions specifically on tax. In this financial year, if you look at it cumulatively, this budget benefits to the tune of, according to the Fiscal Commission, of about £1 billion being available in this financial year as a consequence of the cumulative effect of decisions that have been taken by me and by my predecessors in this role in the course of the last few years.
Okay, I think colleagues might want to look at the net impact of that, but just to focus on what that tax is going to be used for. I mean, obviously there are Barnett consequentials, for example, for health. In addition to those Barnett consequentials, how much additional resources going into the NHS, for example?
The total uplift for the health service, the health and social care portfolio, is approximately £1 billion. And the Barnett consequential, which arose, was of the order of £300 million from recollection. So the Scottish Government is deciding, we're passing on in full that Barnett consequential, but we are going much further in terms of the allocation of resources that we are making.
Okay, thank you. Now, in the draft budget, the Scottish Government's priorities were re-emphasised, and you mentioned them earlier on, ending child poverty, ensuring sustainable public services and accelerating the transition to net zero. But what happened to the commitment to sustainable economic growth, which is necessary to pay for it all? There wasn't any mention of it in the draft budget statement, and the draft budget document suggests as a national outcome of that, and I quote, "We have a globally competitive, entrepreneurial, inclusive and sustainable economy." But there's no detail on how that will be achieved. And obviously, thanks to the economic turmoil exacerbated by the UK government's disastrous decisions last autumn, the UK is now in recession. So how can the Scottish government sustain rapidly rising benefits that will be £1.4 billion higher than if they'd not been devolved, with a shrinking economy, a fall in the working age population and low productivity growth?
I think three key points there, Convener. First of all, the way in which I've presented the economic argument in this budget document is essentially to say that our economic ambitions must be realised through the delivery of a just transition to net zero. So that is essentially the channelling of our economic activity to ensure that out of the transition to net zero, Scotland realises the economic opportunities that are available to us, principally through the delivery of the National Strategy on Economic Transformation. If the committee was to look at the detail of the budget document, I set out very heavily the measures to which we are depending on the success of the National Strategy on Economic Transformation to realise that economic transformation. Secondly, The question that you raise, Convener, in relation to social security expenditure is in a sense a matter of political choice, that the government has opted to make political choices. They are in very stark contrast to the decisions made by the United Kingdom government on issues of welfare, but we have decided to take measures to support individuals that face significant challenge. One particular illustration of that would be the Scottish Child Payment, which accounts for a substantial part of the divergence in expenditure to which you referred, Convener. So that's an act of political choice. And then thirdly, in terms of paying for all of that, well, that has to come from the success that we take forward in boosting productivity and earnings within the Scottish economy, which is the focus of the National Strategy for Economic Transformation, and which I think the estimation from the Fiscal Commission of earnings growth in the next few years indicates a level of confidence from the Fiscal Commission that the measures and priorities that are being put in place will give us the foundations to be able to achieve that increase in earnings growth that the Fiscal Commission has predicted and which underpin the budget announcements that I've made.
I mean, I think the Scottish Child Payment has been a phenomenally positive impact on the tens of thousands, some 400,000 children, I believe, the parents are receiving that. And I think it's made a significant difference. But obviously the whole point about having an anti-poverty strategy is eventually people come out or lifted out of poverty. And I know that the Scottish Government's spending more on employability next year than it had originally intended to do. But if we're actually going to be spending more on anti-poverty measures, by what year will the Scottish Government expect that the work to lower child poverty succeed to the extent that the welfare expenditure actually begins to decline?
In terms of the philosophy behind all of this, Convener, you are correct that the approach that we are taking to ending child poverty is a balanced approach. We take into account direct financial support to families. We take into account efforts to maximise income amongst families. But we also crucially lay the emphasis on the moves into employability and employment for individuals and families. So it is essential that those three elements are kept in proper balance, because you correctly put to me, Convener, the danger and the risk that if those measures are imbalanced, the risk is run that there is a disincentive to enter employment. And that's so there could be pressure, for example, and there is pressure for me to increase the child payment to a higher level than it currently sits at. And I don't think that would be an appropriate step, because it would fall into the position that you are raising, Convener, of disincentivising employment. So there has to be a proper calibrated balance to be established in that respect. And I think we have found that balance in the proposals that we're putting forward. In relation to timescales, we obviously are anxious to make as early progress as we can, and we have statutory targets to meet in this respect. So the statutory targets will be essentially the milestones that we have to achieve, but the government will be working to make progress at an earlier timescale. And I'm optimistic, given the fact that we have a situation just now where we have, comparatively speaking, a lower level of child poverty in Scotland than in other parts of the United Kingdom, that the measures we are taking are working effectively in that direction.
Thank you. Now, raising taxes through fiscal drag impacts adversely on living standards, and it's anticipated that living standards over the next 2 years across the UK are going to fall by 7.1%. On St Andrew's Day, I was privileged to attend the official opening of the £88 million Medicines Manufacturing Innovation Centre in Shannon, which is a world-leading facility, and it's been made possible partly through Scottish Government investment. So given examples of that, is it not time to focus more of the Scottish Scottish Government's limited financial resources on boosting tech scalers. I know there is an element of that in the budget, and I asked about that after your statement, as you know. Startups, research and development, innovation, skills and infrastructure to create high-value jobs, driving up private sector confidence and investment and attracting people of working age from across the UK, not just retirees, and beyond, and deliver the tax revenue needed to pay for the public services that we require.
Again, any balance, any budget, convener, has got to be a balance of all of these factors. So, you know, we are correctly taking steps, I believe, to support people who face significant vulnerability and hardship, but equally we are investing to increase the productive capacity of the economy. So, for example, the commitments that have been made to sustaining investment in the Scottish National Investment Bank, as an example, demonstrates the government supporting the agenda that you're talking about. I've made specific provision in the budget to fund the Tech Scalers programme. The enterprise agencies have had budgets that provide them with stronger resource settlements than they would have anticipated in the resource spending review. The expanded investment in our university sector is designed to assist in that respect as well. The venture that you talked about, convener, the Medicines Manufacturing Innovation Centre, will be a collaboration involving universities, private companies and various other organisations. And in the nature of that collaboration, I think are founded some of the most substantial opportunities to enhance the productive capacity of the economy. So I think if you look at the totality of the budget measures, whether it's the support that we are undertaking to assist new ventures, whether it's the investment through the Scottish National Investment Bank, whether it's the investment to support employability that is about broadening the participation in the labour market, I think there's a range of measures to ensure that Scotland is an attractive place for investment. And of course, the data speaks for itself in the sense that out with the southeast of England and London, Scotland remains the most attractive and successful destination for inward investment of any other part of the United Kingdom.
Okay, thanks for that. Now, Professor Ruin, in evidence to the committee, said that in terms of sustainability, and I quote, it's about optimising the use of digital technologies to be efficient in the delivery of public services. But there's a concern that details of public sector reforms, which were expected with this budget, will now happen in due course, although they were supposed to be with this budget. So when is this likely to be?
The work on public sector reform is an ongoing priority, and there will be a variety of different public sector organisations will be changing the way in which they deliver public services to ensure that they can be as effective and sustainable as possible. We are actively engaging through this budget process with all public bodies to ensure that steps have been taken to maximise the efficiency, because as I set out to Parliament quite openly, there are enormous pressures on our public finances and enormous pressures on the demand on public organisations and agencies. So we have to ensure that we've got appropriate and sustainable methods of delivery in place in all organisations. So that work is essentially an ongoing task as part of the work in which we deliver the budget priorities. If you look in a range of different areas, some examples have been quoted yesterday by the First Minister in the briefing that she gave on the health service about the way in which organisations like NHS 24 or the Scottish Ambulance Service are changing their operational practices and have changed them already to ensure that they can handle more cases in more demanding circumstances than have been the case up until now. So I would assure the committee that the whole question of public service delivery, the reform agenda, is very much an implicit part. Indeed, in part, what I said to the in my budget statement was that there would be significant emphasis on the principles established through the Christie Commission, emphasising early intervention and prevention, which would be at the heart of the work we take forward to deliver person-centred public services. Now, this work was also the subject of a lot of detail set out in the autumn of last year in the COVID recovery strategy, where by joint agreement with local government, we set out how we would move towards person-centred public services, and those plans were openly shared as part of that process.
Yeah, I mean, I take on board what you're saying, but at the time, you know, we had the resource spending review last May, we were advised that we were going to get a package of reforms presented with the budget, and it's not happened, and now it's a kind of, we're being presented with, it's going to be an ongoing kind of situation, a kind of manana approach almost is how it seems. I mean, I think the committee would prefer if we had, if we're going to be told something's going to happen 8 months in advance, that actually happened in 8 months, and if it wasn't possible, because I realise there's been, you know, huge turmoil in the last year, then we were told, well, we've not been able to present this package of reforms by the budget, but we'll do it in March or May or whenever. But it just seems to me that now we're being presented with almost a kind of rolling, a kind of reform thing, which is very difficult to get a grip of and to be able to get a full grasp and to be able to analyse and scrutinise.
The question here, convener, comes down to the sustainability of the budget challenge. And I was very open with Parliament about the scale of the challenge that we face. You know, I set out a number of different factors that were going to have to be considered as part of implementing the budget. You know, the budget contains significant fiscal pressure that will have to be wrestled with by public bodies. There will be public bodies will have to change their way of operation in the course of this financial year to ensure the sustainability of their public services. Now, those will become apparent as organisations take their decisions to live within the resources that have been made available to them. But I would assure the committee that work is actively underway and has been underway for some considerable time.
Okay. Now, in evidence, Dr. Brewer of the Resolution Foundation said that UK government cuts to Scotland's capital allocation of £185 million was, and I quote, not a sensible action, adding that we are pointing the blame principally at the UK government, adding that the decision not to enhance capital funding given the high levels of inflation will lead to a steep decline in the purchasing power of Scottish Government investments. This may hamper the Scottish Government's ability to meet its net zero targets and damage economic recovery. So to what extent is that the case, and how is the Scottish Government trying to mitigate the damage?
We obviously have some scope in relation to capital activity to address some of these issues, principally through capital borrowing. And obviously we've set out in the budget statement the intention to utilise our borrowing facilities in relation to capital projects to the maximum. Now, these will be judgments that were made during the course of the financial year, but particularly more towards the end of the financial year, about the volume of actual borrowing that is required, because that's a product of the interaction between individual projects, the cost of those projects, and the availability of funding. We don't want to borrow if we have no need to borrow to support the projects that we have underway. So those sensitive judgments will be made, but we do have some ability to address those requirements. One of the issues that I have to be particularly mindful of in the current period is the possibility of an implication for our capital programme in this financial year from the United Kingdom Government's supplementary estimates, which we expect to see published sometime over the course of, I would imagine, the next 6 weeks, I would think. And there may be, there's undoubtedly a risk that that may restate capital expenditure within the United Kingdom, which may have a negative effect. I can't see even a positive reaction. It might be neutral or it might be negative. And I have to be mindful of that in terms of the decisions that I take in the course of this, the remainder of this financial year. But the point that Dr. Brewer makes is an important point, because we want to sustain investment in the capital estate of Scotland. I think the one thing, the one other caveat I probably should put on the record in relation to this point is obviously capital projects are significantly affected by the effect of inflation and the effect of input prices, which largely arise out of the global turmoil that we're experiencing as a consequence of the war in Ukraine. So capital projects are, you know, we are looking very carefully at the cost of capital projects, because there may in some circumstances be an argument for delaying commitment to a capital project because the cost at this particular moment may be so great compared to what we would have ordinarily expected to be the case because of the exceptional pressure of global input prices on and inflation on the cost of individual projects. So there's a sensitive set of judgments to be made about whether or not all capital projects that we ordinarily would have been committed to taking forward should be taken forward given the effect of price inflation on those particular projects at this moment in time.
Well, that's quite interesting, because that leads on to my next question. And of course, the issue is that when prices do rise, even if inflation goes back to zero, they're still at a high platform. So that would still be an issue as we move forward. And it takes me to a couple of points. I mean, I would love to actually wade through this if we had the time, this budget, and ask a whole load of questions, but I'm not going to do that. My colleagues would lynch me if I did anyway, and time is against us. But I do want to ask a question about that, because I noticed that More Homes will see its budget fall by 24% next year to £567.5 million. And I imagine you're going to respond that's probably because of the issues you've made about high inflation in terms of materials, etc., need to build these homes. But local government capital grants will increase next year by 19% to £607.6 million. So I'm just wondering what is the thinking behind the decisions to reduce capital spend on housing, but increase it very significantly in terms of the money allocated to local authorities?
Obviously, we need to bear in mind many of the factors that I've just recounted to you in the judgments that we make, and also in relation to the More Homes, the Affordable Housing Programme, for example, that is a programme that will, by its nature, be uneven from year to year because of the nature and the timing of particular projects over the course of... it's a long-term, multi-year programme. I think at least over a 5, if not a 10-year programme. So those numbers will vary from year to year, depending on the maturity of the programme. In relation to local government, obviously the increase in capital grants to local authorities is a material point to consider in relation to the overall local government financial settlement, where local authorities have a significant amount of flexibility in how they utilise the resources that are made available from the Scottish Government. And I think considering all of those issues in the round is important to consider when we look at the financial capacity of local government to take the decisions it's got to take.
I'm sure others will ask about local government, but I just want to go back just very briefly to the NHS. And you were talking about £1 billion additional resource for the NHS and social care. I'm just wondering how much of that additional funding will go towards the establishment of setting up the National Care Service?
In relation to the National Care Service, there's obviously a number of things happening as part of the process. We are investing heavily through the work on the National Care Service in improving the resources that are available in salaries for social care staff, for example. So the National Care Service expenditure will sit within an overall budget which is in excess of £1 billion, £1.1 billion. A substantial part of that is about actually increasing pay for social care staff. So my recollection is that about £100 million of that overall budget will be used to pay for the uplift in social care pay to about to £10.90, which of course builds on the other steps that we've taken to increase pay for social care staff. The committee will be receiving an updated financial memorandum on the what I would call the the logistical arrangements around the National Care Service in future, and the point that you've raised, Convener, will be addressed as part of that exercise.
Well, thanks for confirming that we're going to get an updated financial memorandum. That's very good news. The second thing I was going to ask you was, you talked about £100 million extra going into the National Care Service pay, and I think, again, that's going to be very welcome. For every pound in hourly pay that goes into the wages of care staff, what's the impact on the Scottish budget? So, for example, if you were, say we were to go up from 10.90 to 11.90, right, what would that additional impact be on the Scottish budget? That's could get quite significant, and it's likely to be an issue that comes up, I would imagine, over the next few weeks.
I'd have to write to the committee about that. I better not give the committee a number off the top of my head, so I better write to the committee about that point. Did you have a particular level in mind, Convener, that you would...
Oh, no, just for every pound in...
For every pound?
For every...
We'll give you that figure,
yeah. ..will be on the Scottish budget, because obviously if there's significant increases in that, then the money would have to be found from elsewhere, understandably. OK, colleagues, I'm glad to know there's only a couple more questions for me, then we'll open out. And I'm not going to ask all the juicy questions, but I do want to ask one which is an important one, because this is an issue that's just going back and forward, and it's... in evidence, Professor Roy of the Scottish Fiscal Commission said that in terms of higher rate and additional taxes, and I quote, "The government has to be careful when it thinks about how much additional revenue might come in just because of people's potential behavioural responses." And added that while on paper the extra penny on the additional rate would bring in a further £30 million of taxation, Professor Roy added, and again, I quote, "That is without behavioural change. When you add in the behavioural change, we think the totality of that is only £3 million. Now, other organisations and groups may have different views on that, but that's what he's basically saying with the Scottish Fiscal Commission. So I would ask, therefore, is it worth the bother of adding an extra penny in tax if 90% is going to be lost to behavioural change? And how concerned are you that that level of behavioural change restricts your room to manoeuvre and perhaps would take you to a level whereby if tax went up further, then you might end up in a negative tax-raising situation? And, also on taxation, while we're at it, is the Scottish Government worried about incorporation and the increase of it, and you know, people incorporating to avoid paying taxes, and possibly the image, wrongly in my view, but presented to other parts of the UK that Scotland's a high-tax country?
There's a sizeable number of points in there, Convener, and if the committee is keen for urgent progress, I'll try to keep this as brisk as I can. The first thing to say is that I accept the fundamental point being made by Professor Roy that the government has to be mindful of these questions. I think it would, I readily put that on the record, and it's a question I consider very carefully in relation to the steps that we take. Secondly, when we set out our tax position, we set out, I think, a position that is set out technically, but also in terms of the values of the government and the policies of the government. So we set out technical changes, but we also set out why we are undertaking those technical changes, and they are based on the principles that the government adheres to, that we believe in progressive taxation, and that we believe that higher earners should contribute more in taxation than has previously been the case. So we apply those judgments, and obviously, as I've set out to the committee already in response to your questions, Convener, the budget would be without £519 million as a consequence of the decisions I've taken to change the tax approach that is inherent in the budget, enabling us to better and more substantively invest in public services and in public priorities. Thirdly, there is obviously a risk, the Fiscal Commission acknowledges this and sets out the arguments, that there may be steps taken by people to change their tax affairs to avoid these consequences. Morally, I think that's wrong to do that, but it's technically possible for people to do so, but morally, I believe that's wrong, because people living in Scotland have access to a different set of provisions and services than are available in other parts of the United Kingdom. So somebody may change their tax arrangements to avoid paying certain amounts of tax, but will be prepared to accept that if their child goes to university in Scotland, they will not pay tuition fees, or that they will have access to free prescription charges, or if they've got young children, they'll have a better prospect, a better proposition in early learning and childcare that's available than will be available in the rest of the United Kingdom, or that they will pay comparatively lower council tax in Scotland than in other parts of the United Kingdom. So there's a very strong moral dimension to this, whereby people in Scotland are having access to what I called in the budget statement a social contract of provisions, which I think it's appropriate that we support in these very tough times through the decisions that we've taken on taxation.
There is, of course, an argument, though, that's being made by some people for additional taxation, but the difficulty is it doesn't seem to take into account at all behavioural change. People seem to think that, you know, you know, that if you increase tax by X amount, revenue to the Scottish Government will indeed be X, when in fact that is not the case.
I am required by statute, and I don't complain about this, to use the numbers provided to me by the Fiscal Commission. I think that's the right and proper way to do this. So therefore, I can't ignore what the Fiscal Commission says on these numbers. I see commentary into the debate which suggests material which I couldn't take into account because it's not the view of the Fiscal Commission. The committee's heard the Fiscal Commission's view. I can't ignore that. I have to take that into account. But there is other analysis that suggests, oh, well, if Swinney just went off and did this, there would be so much more money available. Well, unfortunately, that collides with the reality of the assessment put forward by the Fiscal Commission, which I cannot ignore. So I think that's perhaps the best way to convey that point, Convener.
Point taken. And finally, from myself, no doubt when we debate the budget in the Chamber, we will have the usual demands for vast increases in expenditure across every portfolio, accompanied either by tax cuts or, who knows, possibly tax rises. In the 26 days since your budget statement, which political parties have approached you asking to meet to discuss alternative proposals? And of those that do, will you insist that demands for increased spending in one area of the budget are met by identified reductions elsewhere or by specific tax rises in order to meet them to ensure a balanced budget?
Well, since the budget was set out on the 15th of December, I have not had any discussions with other political parties on the budget provisions. I think opposition spokespeople in finance would have wanted me to be the last person they would want to see over the Christmas break, I would have thought. So I think if it was a choice between Santa and John Swinney arriving for a discussion, I think opposition finance spokesman would probably have chosen Santa. But
I didn't expect them to be turned up in your house on New Year's Day.
I had discussions with all opposition parties, all political parties in Parliament prior to the budget being set. I concluded each of those discussions saying that I would resume those discussions once the budget was set out and the dust had settled, and we will have those discussions in the fullness of time. Now, obviously, the convener, you make another important point, which is that dialogue is important, and I want to make sure I hear the perspective of other parties, and I will do my best to address it. But you do make the other important point, which is that I have allocated the resources available to me. I've made choices. Therefore, if I'm going to reallocate money to address issues brought to me by other parties, I have to be confident they can be funded. And that's the requirement that will have to be put on all provisions.
OK, well, thank you very much for that. I'm now going to open up the session, and the first person to ask questions will be Douglas, to be followed by Michelle.
Thank you, Convener. I wanted to ask a question on public service reform. Obviously, that was something that was going to be coming to the budget statement in December, and that's been delayed. Are you able to tell us your thinking on that, you know, the direction of travel within the public sector reform, and when we will actually see things coming forward? Because I would imagine that's going to have an impact on the coming year's budget. So the longer it takes for those reforms to come into place, then the harder it's going to be to set budgets in future years.
I do want to say, I want to reiterate to the committee what I said to the convener, that steps are being taken on a constant basis to reform public services. So the idea that we're waiting for something to happen to undertake public sector reform, I want to debunk that as an idea in front of the committee, because we are constantly changing the way in which public services are being delivered to live within the financial constraints that we are all facing. The government agreed with local government an approach to public service reform through the COVID recovery strategy work, which laid heavy emphasis on the design of person-centred public services, which are about learning some of the important lessons out of COVID and applying those to the delivery of public services. So, for example, we undertake less transactional activity between different aspects of public service, but in fact undertake more the delivery services around individuals to assist them in meeting the challenges that we face. And of course, some of the work that is underway in the Dundee Pathfinder, for example, with which Mr Lumsden may be familiar from his own constituency interest, is exploring how that can be best undertaken by a collaboration involving Social Security Scotland, the Department for Work and Pensions, Dundee City Council and a variety of other organisations, including the third sector, to better meet the needs of individuals and support them. So there is reform work underway. The challenge that public organisations face is that they have to live within the reality of the financial settlements that I can make available to them, and we have provided in the COVID recovery strategy, for example, the means and the mechanisms by which individual organisations can take that forward. Now, there will inevitably be, as a consequence of the budget, the need to put into practice some of the provisions that were set out in the resource spending review around, for example, the size of the public sector workforce. That will be affected by the scale of the budget, and organisations will be taking those decisions based on the financial settlement that the government has made available.
Sorry, will you be coming back to Parliament to present what we would expect in a sort of a future public body landscape, or will that not be happening then?
There may well be changes to the public body landscape that the government takes forward, but fundamentally organisations have to take forward their plans within the resources that the government has made available, and by taking account of the principles that have been set out in the COVID recovery strategy, the resource spending review and what we've set out in the budget document.
And will that encompass the local governance review that was, I think we were meant to see that last year, that we haven't really seen anything on that yet. Will that encompass that going forward?
Well, discussions on the local governance review are part of the invitation I've set out to local government to work with us on constructing what I've described as a new partnership between national and local government to work collaboratively on shared endeavours, which is what we did on the COVID recovery strategy. So that will be inevitably part of those discussions.
And I guess that would tie in things like the National Care Service would be, obviously, that would be shaping some of that governance review as well, I would presume. Other question I had was, when you were talking about ending child poverty, you spoke about employability. In your budget document, it says it's regrettable that there was 54 million, I think, was taken out of that that budget. So how does that tie in with ending child poverty and the you've spoken to this committee before about early intervention and prevention? How does that tie in with that? Obviously, it must have been a tough decision, but how does that tie in with that decision?
The decision, we will spend more next year on we plan to spend more next year on employability than we will be spending this year. So there is an increase in the projected expenditure on employability. But in the emergency budget review, I removed about £54 million worth of expenditure that was planned to be undertaken in employability in this year. So if we had spent that £54 million this year and I'd set the budget that I've set for next year, then there would have been a reduction. But we didn't do that. We took the money out this year. For a reason which I think I explained to this committee, I certainly explained it to the Social Justice Committee, was that at the moment in the financial year, which was quite advanced, where I had to take the emergency budget review decisions, I had a limited range of sources of expenditure that were not legally committed, and those were not legally committed. So I was having to take a set of pretty difficult and abrupt decisions to free up money to afford increased public sector pay bills during this financial year. So what I'd reassure Mr Lumsden about is that we have incremental growth from this year's actual expenditure into next year on employability programmes to support the child poverty reduction activity. And the other factor which allowed me to remove the expenditure that was planned to be undertaken on employability in this financial year was because we still had capacity for individuals on the existing programmes that were left to enter employability activity within the Scottish Government. So that money could be removed because there was still capacity and adequate capacity to enable our child poverty measures to be supported. It's just that we weren't expanding the programmes to the extent that we had predicted.
We'll put it in a slightly different way then. Do you not feel that's an area where more money could be spent that could actually reduce our welfare bill going forwards as people are less dependent on some of the welfare schemes that there are?
That's undeniable. So yes, that could be done, but I have to make a judgment about what resources are available. But I'm very mindful of the fact that one of the ways, and this is one of the key points about the Dundee Pathfinder, which we're looking at very closely, as to what is working about getting supporting people out of economic inactivity and into productive economic activity. And there's some really good learning coming out of that programme so far, which will influence the way in which we deploy employability expenditure in the future. And it may well be, these are often, if I come back to my point about capacity, these are essentially demand-led programmes. So if I find during the course of the next financial year, or if I hope the Finance Secretary, who should be here doing this, finds in the course of next year that there is the need for there to be more investment because the capacity is being used up already, then that's obviously an issue which would be one for substantial consideration.
And last question, if I may. The poundage rates for non-domestic rates has been frozen. But when we look at the budget, the actual intake from non-domestic rates has increased quite substantially. I presume that's because of revaluation that's just taken place. Are you able to say what the revaluation role has increased from and to at the recent revaluation?
I don't think I can give you that precise information just now, but I will write to the committee with the best available information that we have. Now, obviously, quite a number of... I'm not sure we actually will be able to give that number because there will still be appeals under consideration. But I'll give the committee the best information that I can at this stage.
Even on the estimated new role, that would be helpful. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Douglas. Michelle, to follow by Liz.
Good morning, Deputy First Minister. Just picking up on a couple of points posited by the convener. In terms of capital expenditure, you've given a kind of clear rationale around the kind of global economic considerations and that therefore you might seek to delay rather than stop projects. But I suppose that makes me think every capital project is going to be impacted by what you describe and therefore every capital project could potentially be delayed. Can you give any more flavour to the type of project that you have in mind?
First of all, let me give the assurance that I don't think it applies universally to all capital projects, because you will have, if I differentiate, for example, between higher education research expenditure, which is covered by capital expenditure, I don't think that's in any way affected by, I don't think that's affected to the extent that a project that is heavily reliant on input materials will be affected. So construction projects are a significant concern at the present moment because of price inflation on raw materials, and that obviously can affect the judgments. Now, you know, that's not me indicating that that judgment will be applied in all circumstances. We have to be mindful of where and when it is appropriate to make that judgment, but it's a relevant factor to consider.
Thank you for that clarification. So within that then, I mean, you mentioned construction, when we know we've got still a chronic undersupply of particularly affordable housing and massive pent-up demand that goes back years. Are you able to give any more flavour at this point as to the type of project that you might seek, or sector that you might seek to impose a delay for the circumstances that you've outlined?
We'll simply have to look at that on a project by project basis. I think it's we need to see what price estimates are coming in for projects. We need to make a judgment on the nature of the sustainability of those projects. So that will be an ongoing consideration during the year. But I think it's important that I flag up to the committee at the outset that this is a material consideration in how we proceed through this period. I'm very mindful of the fact, you know, there'll be wider considerations to be borne in mind. The point that Michelle Thompson makes about the importance of a constant attention to the affordable housing challenge is an important point, and one that would obviously weigh heavily in decision making and determination on these points. And you know, there's commitments which, as we speak, are being made in relation to affordable housing projects in this financial year, despite the fact that we're facing these enormous external pressures.
I have every sympathy with the situation the Deputy First Minister finds himself in, operating as a finance secretary, but I suppose the reason I'm asking for that and clarity is from a business investment point of view, that businesses themselves will be determining at what point they too will be seeking to make investment, and therefore what the Scottish Government's appetite is given the constraints that you outlined. So do you plan further announcements to give much needed certainty to various business sectors, of which construction is one?
Obviously, I don't think I can go further than to say that obviously that these matters will be considered on a project by project basis. But I would make the point that the government does fully intend to deploy a £6.3 billion worth of capital expenditure. So the point I'm making is, in a sense, a marginal point in relation to the totality of that programme. So we will be working to deploy £6.3 billion of capital expenditure within the next financial year. So business organisations can look at that and they can see how that's distributed across the range of different portfolio areas and the plans that have been set out in the budget document, and I think can take some confidence that the government is going to be investing heavily in the capital estate of the country, but that there may be certain projects that might not proceed as originally timetabled, but that will be at the margins of that programme.
Okay. And so, I mean, we know, I mean, it's been mentioned earlier that the CapEx figure is set to fall by 2.9% in real terms. Are you able to give any update as to, I mean, I know a terms of reference for the fiscal framework review is underway, but are you sensing any increasing urgency for that, given the calls, probably fairly common, for an increase in CapEx borrowing powers from the Scottish Government? Are you feeling any sense of increased urgency from the UK Government?
The discussions with the UK Government on the fiscal framework have essentially taken account of the kind of transactional work around about the evidence review that is being prepared. I've not had any further discussions with the UK government about the fiscal framework review beyond that, if my memory serves me right. But obviously, we've set out some of the issues that we have in relation to the scope of our financial powers and responsibilities, and we'll engage with the United Kingdom government on those points.
Okay, and still on this sort of theme, net zero in terms of CAPEX is a particular concern, and we know that it will involve some very difficult decisions, and you yourself have commented that it will some genuinely difficult decisions for Scotland, requiring significant long-term private investment and behaviour change. And I wondered what you meant by behaviour change in that context.
Just really how we as a society operate and utilise our resources. So I'm thinking principally in that respect around about our use of transport. Transport is a very significant factor in the journey to net zero. So changing the way in which we all undertake our transport activity is a significant factor in that exercise. But there's wider issues about resource use and about the steps that we all take to ensure that we are doing as much as we can to support the net zero agenda.
Okay, thank you. And last wee question, just picking up on the point about behavioural change. In fact, I've got two more points. It seems to me that it must be increasingly complex to try and model behavioural change within the complexity of the existing fiscal framework and the wider economic environment. Are the models that you're using, are they evolving, or are they fit for a purpose? Because it seems to me that it must be extremely complex. It's probably a slightly technical question, but
these are technical challenges, yeah. And my officials wrestle with these questions. The Fiscal Commission wrestles with these questions, and of course, you know, we are dependent on the Fiscal Commission for their final view in relation to behavioural change. And as I set out to the convener, it is right and appropriate that I should be dependent on the Fiscal Commission for that conclusion. But I think the nature, one of the observations I would have, you know, I was the finance minister for 9 years. I've obviously come back into this area of activity after a bit of a gap. And my observation would be that the arrangements are a great deal more complex than they were when I left the role in 2016. And this particular issue that Michelle Thompson puts to me is just one example of the need for a more sophisticated understanding of the choices and decisions that people make, and that work is being constantly addressed to try to ensure it's of the highest possible quality. But of course, these are predictions and assessments. There will be outturns, and we will see the validity of some of those judgments in due course.
Okay, thank you. And last question, I mean, it's been alluded to, and I'm sure other members may want to pick up on it a bit more, but we've got huge demands for public sector pay deals, and it must be a massive challenge at the moment. Now, I know that the government are working extremely hard to reach agreement with various different pay demands, but I wanted to ask, what contingencies have you got in place if no deal can be reached by the end of this fiscal year with any particular sector?
We're obviously working hard to resolve outstanding pay deals. You know, we find ourselves in a situation just now where, for example, in the health service, some of the unions have accepted the deal, and some are yet to accept the deal. And we're obviously continuing those discussions, and we are trying to avoid industrial action to the greatest extent possible. Obviously, there are some other workforces where we are yet to reach agreement, and I would simply reassure the committee that we are working actively in dialogue to try to address all these questions. I think the difficulty I face in this financial year. It's, as I've reported to Parliament and reinforced to the committee today, I am yet to find a path to balance this financial year about which I can be confident. So that means that the offers that we have made available for this year, with the resources that are available, are essentially the best I can make available in this financial year. So that is a material factor in those discussions, which we obviously will continue our dialogue with relevant trade unions, but I am significantly constrained. If, for example, I was to offer more money for a particular pay deal in this financial year, I would have to find that money, and it would simply add to the total that I am still trying to resolve in this financial year. So there is a real cash pressure. Now, the one caveat I have to say in that is that the United Kingdom government is yet to set out its supplementary estimates. I don't know what will come out of that process. As I said, I expect that to be within the next 6 weeks or so. And obviously, if there's any relevant issues that arise out of that, I would, of course, advise the committee.
So, last sort of finer point, they say it's difficult to get a man to understand something when his salary depends on him not understanding. And probably this is very much what we're seeing with a fixed budget model. And we know in this committee it's always a concern that to what extent do the public understand how the framework, financial framework for the Scottish Parliament operates. And I know you yourself and all your ministers have been at pains to help people understand what a fixed budget actually means. But I still hear, whether it's politics or otherwise, but even kind of media representatives blithely ignoring the fact there's a fixed budget and the implications flowing therein. I know you work very hard to try and get that message out there, but is there anything more that you can do, and indeed is there anything more that we can do to help support that?
I think the committee, I think, well understands the challenges that I face. Once a financial year starts, once I have set tax rates, unless there is a change through the Barnett formula, there is we are essentially operating in a fixed budget, and that's the position I find myself in at this moment in this financial year. It's a different set of arguments about the next financial year, which I've completely accepted, and I've responded to that in the budget statement with the changes to tax position that I've set out. But there is quite literally a remaining amount of money to be spent between now and the 31st of March, and I have to live within that limit. And as I've said to the committee, I am yet to be confident that I have a path to balance within that. So that's a very significant position, a position I never found myself in at this stage in the financial year in my 9 years when I was Finance Secretary. So it's an entirely novel situation I find myself in. Not a particularly welcome novel situation, but it's a novel situation nonetheless. And I'm, when I finish this session, I will be meeting with my finance team to take stock on where we are and what further steps we've got to take. And then if I was, for example, to make further commitments beyond what we are already committed to in this financial year, I would have to find the money for that. And that would have to come from not taking forward other programmes that might be there to be taken forward. But I have to say, having looked very carefully at what is called the remaining spend analysis for this financial year, there isn't an awful lot of flexibility that remains for me in the next 3 months.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Liz, to be followed by Ross.
Thank you. Mr. Swinney, I wonder if I could start my questions with a point of clarification. The First Minister wrote in the Financial Times in November, and I quote, "The budget of the Scottish Government, for example, is worth £1.7 billion less than when it was set in December as a result of inflation." That's a figure I've heard you agree with in the Chamber. But she added, and again I quote, "Yet we have not received a single additional penny from the UK Government." Do you agree with that second part, that you have not received any additional penny from the UK Government?
Yes.
Can you just explain why you think that's true when the Scottish Fiscal Commission outlined very extensive Barnett consequentials for the period 2021-22 and also for 2022-23? I think the current ones are something like 447 million.
Because of the simple point, which is the point the First Minister is making in that article, that the Scottish Government's budget for financial year 22-23 was essentially formulated in the autumn of 2021 based on UK numbers in autumn 2021 when inflation was at, you know, its pretty consistently low level that it's been for most of the last 30 years. And by the start of the financial year, we're seeing inflation galloping to, well, it's now reached, well, it was at 11%. And there was no change to the fiscal arrangements being made available in 22-23 to take account of that.
Not correct to say that there was not a single penny more from the UK government.
Yeah, I think it is, yeah. I've just explained why that's the case.
Well, is the Scottish Fiscal Commission wrong to say that the Barnett consequential sums that they've given, that's...
The point that Liz Smith is missing and what I'm saying is which is the point the First Minister was making, which was the financial arrangements for financial year 22-23 were largely set in a low inflation climate in the autumn of 2021. By the time we started facing the reality of financial year 22-23, inflation was galloping away from us and there was no subsequent adjustment of the financial year 22-23 financial provisions from the UK government.
I think we'll have to disagree on that point, and I think some commentators...
No, well, I'm not, no, we'll stay here all afternoon, convener, because, Liz Smith is not accepting the point I'm making, which is the point the First Minister was making, which was the budget parameters were set by the UK government in the autumn of 2021 when inflation was flat as a pancake. By the time the financial year started, the UK government had not revised its financial estimates and inflation was galloping like a racehorse. That's the problem.
Well, as I say, I think we'll have to disagree on that point. Over the last 5 years, I think it is, when Scottish income tax policy was obviously divergent from the rest of the UK tax policy because of the new powers that the Parliament has had, the Scottish Government's obviously been able to generate additional revenues, but these have partially been offset by weaker growth in income tax per head, and you yourself earlier this morning admitted that the potential additional spending power has partly been offset by weaker economic performance in Scotland. And, you know, weaker performance in the economy is true in the UK as well, but it's weaker in Scotland. So can I just ask you about what specific economic policies do you think should be prioritised to ensure that productivity in Scotland is enhanced?
I think there's a range of things that we need to do, which are set out in the National Strategy for Economic Transformation. I think, first of all, we've got to have very clear and effective regional economic strategies within Scotland and regional economic measures so that in all parts of the country we have distinctive approaches that will best address the needs and circumstances in different localities. An important point in that respect, for example, is the investment the government has made in the transition funds in the northeast of Scotland, for example, to support the transition to for the oil and gas sector. And that's an indication of us tangibly and practically putting in place regional economic strategy mechanisms. The south of Scotland, we have a distinctive south of Scotland economic strategy led by the, or supported by South of Scotland Enterprise, that the government actively engages in, which is about enhancing some of the opportunities within the tourism, the leisure environment, and the productive capacity of the food and drink sector. So that's some examples in relation to regional economies. Secondly, we've got to invest in the activity around about tech development within Scotland, so the tech scalers investment, for example, which has been commissioned from Codebase and which has now been rolled out in different parts of the country. Convener referred to that in his own initial answer. So that investment in the capacity of the tech sector is important. Thirdly, I think we've got to engage very substantially and enhance the already developing collaborations between the university research sector and the business community. I think we're in a much, much stronger position today than we were 5-10 years ago as a consequence of that. I think universities have responded magnificently to this challenge, and I think the business community, they've opened their doors much more effectively to the business community, and business community is much more engaged. So I'm very optimistic that that work will be undertaken and will be effective. I think the last point I'd make in this respect is about the Fiscal Commission's assessment about what lies ahead, because it's, you know, I know this is an annual budget process, and we obviously look at snapshots of information given this financial year and the next financial year. When the Fiscal Commission has to do something slightly different. They've got to look, yes, at the individual year-by-year performances, but they've also got to give a sense of what their expectations are about the direction of travel. And their expectations about the direction of travel on earnings growth in Scotland are very different in the period going forward to what we've just gone through. And I think that's an indication of some of the progress that we can expect to make on productivity.
Thank you. That's a helpful list. One of the things you didn't mention, and I've heard you mention in the Chamber quite rightly, is that there are concerns on a demographic basis that the size of the working population in relation to total population is a major concern. And I think you're right about that. Can I just ask about taxation policy, particularly, I think, for those who are earning £27,850 now, anything at that level and or above, these people are paying a higher rate of tax than is the case in the rest of the UK. We've talked a little bit this morning about behavioural change. Are you concerned that any of these people who are middle to upper earners will feel that perhaps Scotland is not the most attractive place in which to live, work and to invest?
The first thing I'd say is that I don't consider the position that we're taking to be having a discernible effect on middle-income earners in Scotland. I think we are, the steps that we are taking are essentially affecting individuals who would be in the top two quartiles of the population in terms of earnings. So that's the first point I'd make, that I think we are concentrating the measures that we're taking on the top two quartiles. So we're not discernibly affecting middle income earners. The second point I'd make is a point that I made I think in response to questions from the convener, that when people choose to live in Scotland, they know that they are gaining access to a much wider range of public service provision and opportunities than would be the case if they lived in other parts of the United Kingdom. And you know, I won't rehearse all the details, but free personal care, tuition fees, early learning and childcare, prescription charges. We've made certain choices that are available to members of the public in Scotland. And I think that would feature in the judgments and decisions that individuals will take. And lastly, I think people make a judgment about a range of different factors that about where they live and where they work. And I think Scotland, from a variety of different perspectives, whether it's the social contract that I talked about, or whether it's the quality of life, or the access to facilities and services, Scotland is a very attractive place for people to live and to work. And and would be reflected so in the judgments that individuals would make.
Thank you. I take your point about some of that, but notwithstanding the advantages that, or the perceived advantages that people in Scotland may have, if they're being asked to pay higher levels of tax than elsewhere, what they are looking for is effective delivery of public service. And I just wonder, in the current circumstances, if you look at NHS or you look at schools or you look at transport, and also actually if you listen to some of the commentaries from yesterday, what is it that you feel is additional in terms of the quality of the delivery of public services that merits these higher tax rates?
I think it's pretty clear that every health service in the Western world is under colossal pressure just now. So Scotland's service is no different. But as has been rehearsed on countless occasions, and indeed Liz Smith's colleagues vigorously resist this point being made, but I shall make it again. If we look at A&E performance, although Scotland's performance is not as good as we would want it to be, it's better than other parts of the United Kingdom. So there's one example of how the delivery of public services is better in Scotland than in other parts of the United Kingdom. Let's take schools. When I became a minister, 63% of pupils in Scotland were educated in good or satisfactory school buildings. That figure is now over 90%. I'm very, very proud of the investment we've made in the school estate. Young people have been educated in much, much better conditions than was the case before, with a higher expenditure per capita in education than in other parts of the country. And in my experience, and I know this doesn't suit the narrative of some people in this building, young people are getting a fabulous education within Scotland. And yes, it's disrupted today because of industrial action, but you know, I can't spend money I don't have on pay claims that I can't afford, and I've been completely candid about that point. And then on transport, the government has invested very significantly in expanding the rail network, for example, in expanding electrification programmes. We have put in place concessionary travel schemes for older people and for younger people. The use of the younger people's concessionary travel card has been phenomenal, giving young people much more mobility and flexibility. These are some of the things that I think people in Scotland are experiencing, which are all to the good.
People are they're not finding it easy to see their GP. They're finding that when it comes to cuts in bus services or in some train services or on services that provide our islands, etc., there's a whole lot of things which I think are adding up to concerns about the delivery of public services, and I think that is reflected in what some comments were being made yesterday. Could I ask you about one other aspect of tax chain, and that's about the additional dwelling supplement, because the Scottish Government is forecasting that we get this extra revenue in from that tax change. Has the government done any modelling about that extra tax change in light of the number of people who are saying that they might leave the market for additional dwelling supplements as a result of the rent-free situation?
Well, these judgments are not the Scottish Government's judgments. These are modelled by the Fiscal Commission. So these are not the, so, and they will take into account behavioural change, as we have rehearsed here already. So I do accept that the additional dwelling supplement is projected to increase the revenue take to the Scottish Government. I accept that that may provide a disincentive for people to acquire an additional property. That may well be a consequence, but that then will free up that property to be bought by somebody else who may be buying it as the first property from which we are likely to get, or we may well get, a land and buildings transaction tax payment into the bargain. So the behavioural factors will be will be factored into the analysis as a consequence of the work that the Fiscal Commission has undertaken.
OK, thank you.
Thank you. Ross, to be followed by Daniel.
Thanks, Convener. Brief question on this current year's budget, Deputy First Minister, before moving on to the draft budget for next year. At what point should we be expecting the spring budget revision, given the current uncertainties around, for example, public sector pay settlements?
At what moment?
Yeah, it's usually the end of January, start of February, but I'm presuming it may be somewhat later than this time.
I can't give a definitive answer, so I better write to the committee. I think I'm obviously looking very carefully at the interaction with the supplementary estimates, because that may well have an effect. And I suspect that we will have a better idea of that by the middle of February, which, of course, is really quite an advanced stage of the budget scrutiny process here. I think it's unlikely that a spring budget revision will be brought to Parliament before the conclusion of the budget process on stage three of this budget bill. But I'll confirm with the committee in writing when I've got a better idea about that position.
That'd be useful. Thanks. Turn to the next year's budget, the current draft. What status should we give now to the resource spending review? I mean, obviously, when that was developed and published, it was with an acknowledgement that as each year covered by the RSR went on, it would almost certainly gradually diverge from it. But we're now in the position where in year one, there is immediate and significant divergence. Your local government is £550 million more than what was laid out in the RSR. If I were in local government trying to plan ahead for their budgets, should I presume that the 24-25 budget will be flat cash relative to what's proposed for next year? Should I be looking back at the numbers that are still contained in the RSR for that year?
I think the resource spending review remains a very relevant consideration for all stakeholders in the public finances, because not necessarily because of the precise details that will be in it, but because of the shape of the way in which the public finances are developing. And I think essentially what's happened with what we envisaged when the resource spending review was set out was essentially two early tough years and two latter better years. What we have got from the UK government statement in November is two relatively less painful years to begin with and two much more painful years to conclude with. Now, that doesn't, you know, I could draw a couple of lines on paper and try and present a graph of all of that, how that all fits together. But roughly what it says to me is that the next four years are going to be really tough on the public finances. So years one and two are years of adjustment. Years three and four are years of consolidation of real difficulty. Now, some might say, well, there's a lot of water to go under the bridge between now and then. When I listen to these are the plans of the current United Kingdom government. When I listen to the comments made the other day by the Leader of the Opposition, it doesn't give me much sense that there will be much of a departure from the public expenditure outlook that has been suggested by but that has been planned for by the current United Kingdom government, should there be a change of government at the next Westminster general election. So, in answering Mr. Greer's question, I think the direction of travel of the resource spending review remains absolutely valid, while some of the numbers may be different as a consequence.
I appreciate that answer, but if I'm in local government, or say the university sector, which, like local government, is somewhat better off than what it was planning for through the RSR, though I acknowledge that they will continue to ask for, to feel that they need more. If I'm to use the RSR for forward planning, on what basis should I now do that, given that the specific numbers in it are no longer valid? Should I presume the kind of broad trajectory of it, so for example the flat cash trajectory for those sectors, we take universities as an example, should I now start assuming flat cash based on what's in the 23-24 budget for 4-5-5-6?
I wouldn't want to be drawn onto such a specific response as that in relation to the to an individual sector. What I would say is that I think organisations and sectors should draw the conclusion from my original remarks that, frankly, 23-24 and 24-25 are going to be the buoyant years, and the 2 years after that are going to be much more difficult years as a consequence, and that will have to play through into all sectors of the public finances.
Thanks. And just one final question, going back to what various committee members have already asked about in relation to behaviour change and tax policy. If we go back to previous relatively significant changes in tax policy, so the 2018 changes to its income tax, the changes to council tax perhaps, I think, were the same year, perhaps the year before it. Was there a significant difference between the outcome of those changes and the eventual revenue raised and the behaviour changes initially assumed by the SFC? And I recognise that there's some questions here in terms of methodology, which is for the Fiscal Commission, but from your perspective, did the behaviour change result in anything significantly different to what had been budgeted for?
I don't know if we have information of the granular level that would answer Mr Greer's question, but I will take that away and see if there is a way in which we can do that. What I would say is that in terms of reconciliations that have taken place, I don't feel that in terms of my knowledge or awareness of reconciliations that have taken their course, that they would indicate much divergence from what was planned. But I think it's probably better if I take this whole question away and give the committee a more substantive answer in writing on that.
Thanks. I acknowledge it will be very hard to disaggregate the specific behaviour changes as a result of changing tax policy versus wider factors in the economy. But obviously, if we're looking at scrutinising future direction of tax policy, if it's at all possible to disaggregate that, I think it would be very valuable.
But I'll look to give the committee a more considerate view about that.
Thank you. That's all from me.
Thank you. Daniel, to be followed by John.
Thank you very much, Convener. Deputy First Minister, you've already set out, and I think it's very clear to everyone, you know, that there are challenges, pressures and priorities and choices reflected in the budget. And those things are not necessarily in isolation. And if we look at the public service sector at the moment, there are huge demands being placed on it, that there are also vacancies, and then people very rightly want to protect their levels of pay. But that, you know, it's not a linear problem that the government has in front of it. So with that in mind, I'd just like to step through the budget decisions made within the NHS in particular. So there's £1 billion as a whole being put into the NHS budget. But then breaking that down, around £500 million is going towards territorial boards. Now, my understanding is around two-thirds of the funding allocated to territorial boards goes on pay. So that would appear to, if my maths is correct, that reflects the 7.5% pay offer. Now, that hasn't been accepted by all parties. So I'd be interested to know what happens within that. Is there, if the government has to settle higher than that, or if the total pay awards comes in higher than 7.5%, will the territorial boards have to find that increase themselves, or will there be shifts within the NHS budget overall from the national budget lines into territorial boards? Really, what I'm asking is, what are the issues, risks and flexibilities within the NHS budget lines in the budget document presented?
I think the first point I'd make, just for absolute clarity, is that the pay offer that's on the table, which has been accepted by some but not all trade unions, is for this current financial year. So we haven't yet negotiated next year's pay award. And we have to... So the type of calculation that Mr Johnson seeks to make involves information which is not yet clear as to what the final cost will be. I suppose what I would be, I'd probably best say in response is that I have tried to firstly maximise the resources available to the health service in the budget settlement by moving substantially beyond the consequentials to provide an uplift to support the health service. Secondly, I have tried to be as mindful as possible within the resources available to me about the about pay demands and pay pressures that will exist. And thirdly, that once we get into the financial year, we will be operating within largely a fixed financial envelope, given that I will have taken the decisions about, well, I have taken the decisions on tax. Parliament has got to decide whether it wishes to endorse those decisions on tax. If Parliament endorses those decisions, that will essentially fix our budget for 23-24, and we will have to manage all the range of pressures within that fixed financial envelope.
I mean, I guess the simpler way of putting the point is, strikes me that within the health service budget that there is limited flexibility, and it's just really why I'm clarifying that detail. But going further, I mean, you, in response to the convener's question on the National Care Service, you did outline sums that were included within it for pay itself, and I understand that. But what you didn't specify is actually what the sum was that's been allocated to the setting up of the care service itself. Now, the current financial memorandum stipulates a range between £60 million and £90 million just in set-up costs. Now, I understand they may change, but is that sort of order of magnitude of funding within the current budget, and if so, where? Because it's not entirely obvious on the reading of the budget that I've made of where that is.
Any costs arising from the establishment of the National Care Service will be contained within the budget line, which includes the, you know, which is the £1.1 billion in social care support and National Care Service delivery. Now, as I said earlier on, there will be a revised financial memorandum sent to the committee, which will reflect the up-to-date assessment about how that is being taken forward. But that budget line does involve a range of other items, not least of which is the uplift to social care pay that will be taken forward. And of course, the work on the National Care Service is about more than just the establishment of the infrastructure of the National Care Service. It's also about the issues about pay and recruitment that we've talked about on many occasions.
I mean, the budget line you just quoted, I think, is level 3 budget line. That's quite high level. And can I just clarify again? Is that £60 to £90 million figure contained within that?
As I say, I think the best thing I can say is that the financial a revised financial memorandum will come to the committee that will set out the most up-to-date position on these issues.
And of course, overall, I mean, we've already highlighted the fact that around £100 million is the figure for the uplift to social care workers. I think we've already, I think, you know, acknowledged that the key driver of increased costs in the health service is again pay. I think all of which underlines the importance of having a national pay policy, which obviously was not published with the budget. I'm just wondering when that might be expected and what we might expect to see within it, because we've also, it's not just a question of pay, we've also had questions around overall size of the public sector workforce alluded to. I mean, will it include that level of information, at least in terms of outlined strategy from the government?
It will not include that type of detail, no, because the pay policy would never include that type of detail. That's, you know, that is essentially a consequence of the budget settlement that we are able to put in place. And the degree to which we can configure services to deliver against those budgets. Obviously, the government has a long track record of preserving public sector employment. We believe it is important that our public services are well supported by strong levels of employment, although I acknowledge the challenges in recruitment to aspects of public sector employment which are fairly extensive, and would be helped if we had a different approach to migration policy, which, to complete one of the points that Liz Smith made to me, is an issue about which I remain concerned. So, the in terms of pay policy, I'm continuing to consider what is the most appropriate time to set out pay policy. There's a number of variables, not least of which will be the pattern of inflation. I made the point earlier on that we set the budget for this current financial year when the inflation climate was benign, and then we found ourselves wrestling with pay claims when the inflation level was far from benign. So that will be one of the factors that I will consider about what's the most appropriate point at which to set a pay policy. Having said that, there is absolutely nothing to stop open dialogue with trade unions at this moment about the agreement of pay levels for 23-24. The absence of a pay policy is not an impediment to that dialogue being advanced, and obviously we have the mechanisms available within government to resolve any of these questions should they come to a point where they require a decision.
It's not an impediment, but it might be a useful context to those discussions, because if I think if all parties understand the broad parameters the government's working in, that allows for more constructive negotiations, does it not? Can I just push a little bit further? You've absolutely made no commitment around timetable at all, but do we have at least some indication whether we should expect it within months? And at least would you acknowledge that having that context may be useful?
I think the point I was making in explaining the difficulty we found ourselves in this financial year of setting a pay policy at 2% when inflation was benign and then finding ourselves in a completely different situation is that, I question the value of having a pay policy because I don't think it actually helps provide much guidance. 2% provided zero guidance to people as to how they were to navigate this. And what we did during the financial year was we put in place a lot of arrangements within government. I chaired a regular discussion of ministers across the government looking at the current negotiations and giving guidance as to what we consider to be acceptable in relation to resolving these questions. So I don't actually think, in the volatility we've got, I don't actually think the context that would help to shape the context. But I do want to reinforce the point that I made earlier, that the absence is not an impediment to dialogue. Because I really would not want anybody to think we cannot begin to embark on discussions with trade unions because we don't have a pay policy. That is completely the opposite of my intention here.
On the one hand, I accept your point. If a pay policy is merely an academic exercise that bears no relation to reality, I quite agree. That's of no use to anyone. However, if we're going to get through this, to both deal with the challenges that I alluded to in my sort of opening remarks, and indeed, I think, ensure that we have adequate pay for people doing extremely valuable work, you do need, if not a pay policy, you need a workforce plan to ensure that you've got the right people doing the right jobs at the right time at the right pay levels. So does that imply that we actually need what I think Audit Scotland called for is a more comprehensive workforce strategy across the public sector? And can I just set out some facts here? Because I think it's quite interesting. Since quarter one 2020, the total devolved public sector headcount has increased by 31,000. And if you look at the split of that, which I think is quite revealing, it's very roughly a third between local government, the NHS, which I think we can understand in terms of the pressures from COVID, why you'd need extra people. But the final third was actually the civil servants. We've seen an increase of around 8,000 in that period in the slightly less than that, actually. It's around 6,000 in civil service alone. I just wonder whether or not, I agree with the point that we must protect public service jobs, but there's a need to look at the balance of where we're allocating resource in the public sector between, you know, in crude terms, frontline, non-frontline. And would you expect that balance to maybe change, perhaps not over the course of this budget, but future budgets? And is that what a kind of comprehensive workforce plan needs to think about and reflect?
I think some of the changes that Mr. Johnson puts to me will, of course, arise out of the changes in the powers and responsibilities of the Scottish Government. So, for example, mm-hmm. in 2020, we were in the foothills of establishing Social Security Scotland. I'm not even sure if we're in the foothills then. We must have been
in Social Security Scotland at that point, is my understanding.
You know, so there's going to be, you know, there would be significant change arising out of all of that activity. So there will be legitimate changes that come out of the changes in responsibilities of government. But, you know, it's absolutely vital that all organisations must have a workforce plan. We set out our financial frameworks, which obviously have a significant influence on the nature of those plans. Organisations need to keep those up to date and relevant to meet the challenges of our time, and that's, you know, that's exactly the approach that the government takes on all of these questions.
So ultimately, the reason I'm asking these questions is that, you know, a statement has been made by your immediate predecessor, and indeed I think you've reiterated that public sector headcount will have to return to pre-pandemic levels. Now, as long as it's as broadly stated that, I think there will rightly be a degree of anxiety amongst those working in the public sector as to whether or not, you know, their bit is the one that may come under scrutiny. So I'd just like to clarify, is that still the commitment? And if so, I mean, it strikes me that there needs to be some clarity from the government about how and when, over what period of time that might be implemented. Otherwise, I think it will cause anxiety, and surely the government needs to clarify what it means by that, if it still does intend to implement that.
Well, that remains the government's intention, and I think it's largely driven, a number of my responses have been designed to set this out to the committee, that there will be consequences of the decisions that are taken in terms of budget arrangements, which will have an impact on the size and the scale of the workforce. And to come back to the point I made in response to Mr. Greer's questions to me, the shape of the financial outlook in the years to come does not encourage a view about expansion, because we are facing two, comparatively speaking, less challenging years in the first 2 years of the outlook on the spending period against two really tough years at the latter part of the spending period. Now, that's a different shape to what was envisaged in the resource spending review, but it remains relevant in the sense that previously we looked like we were going to be facing two acute years of challenge and two easier years. It's been reversed, so we'll still have to face some of those realities, and budget provision will dictate a large measure of that.
Can I just ask one final technical question about the government has made the commitment to present this budget providing analysis in terms of the spend on COFOG categories, and I believe that's forthcoming. Can I just ask whether or not it will set out the previous year's budget on a similar basis, and whether or not that will be done in terms of the budget as passed, or budget in terms of on the basis of subsequent reviews? Because obviously having that base of comparison is as important as having that categorisation if we're aiming to do that.
I'm not certain that we will show prior year assessments, but if we were, it would have to be on the basis of Budget Act provisions. So that's the like-for-like comparison that we always undertake. It's Budget Act versus budget proposal is the comparison that we undertake. because obviously there's a significant amount of variability there thereafter. But that gives us the one moment in time comparison that can be valid. But I'll confirm that point to the committee in writing.
Thank you. That would be helpful. Thank you, Convener.
Last but not least, John.
Kind of you, Convener. Thank you. Just to pursue a little bit on the pay side of things, if I'm understanding things correctly, for the current year, there was 2% built into the budget. I think you kind of indicated during the year that, you know, we could cope with up to 5%, but once it went over 5%, you really have to make cuts to balance that out and to pay extra. So looking forward to next year, what is built into the budget as an assumption for pay?
I have not built assumptions into the budget on pay. What I have done is undertake to, using the most careful judgment I can deploy, looking at the challenges and pressures that exist across the public sector, what is the best distribution of public resources, and obviously judgments about pay have to be made within the parameters set by those judgments.
Yeah, okay. And to pursue something that Michelle Thompson, I think, raised, a kind of practical point, is if one or more of these pay disputes is not settled by the 31st of March, presumably then there's money sitting in this year's budget that could have been paid out but wouldn't be till next year. So will that go into the reserve?
That depends on where we end up in this financial year, because as you know, I have an expectation, prediction about where we might end up in this financial year. And as I've said to committee already on a couple of occasions today, I am not in a position yet to see that in balance. So part of the resources that part of the sum that I've not yet been able to reconcile will involve an assumption on certain pay deals. So for example, the difference between 2% and 2% and 5% for the teacher's pay deal will be in my contingency element that I've not yet resolved. So if that doesn't get, if I get to the end of the financial year and I've got an underspend and there's the difference between 2% and 5% on a teacher's pay deal, then yes, that can go into the carryover. But if I've not been able to balance this year, that money doesn't exist.
Are you looking at another emergency budget review before the end of the year? Or?
I'm constantly looking at what steps I've got to take. You know, I'm not doing another emergency budget review because I've done one already. But I am constantly looking at how do I find a path to balance, because it's my legal duty to balance the budget, and I've got quite a number of variables about which, you know, so it's not, we're not at the end of the financial year or the end of the road yet. I've got a long way to go on that, and there's a lot of variables, not least of which is the supplementary estimates from the UK government. But, you know, the point I make is that I may have a notional allocation of a sum of money to meet a pay deal, but if I don't balance, that money doesn't exist.
Yeah, you mentioned the UK, so if they end up settling, say, with the health workers for more than they are currently offering, that would mean a knock-on benefit for us. Is that right?
Depends if that arises out of additional allocation to the Department for Health and Social Care, from which there would be a consequential. So if, for example, we look at the announcements made yesterday by the United Kingdom government on the management of NHS pressures, no consequentials arise for us out of that, because that was out of existing committed DHSC resources, as I understand it just now. But if there was to be a cash injection from the Treasury into the Department for Health and Social Care to meet the costs of a pay deal, because as I understand it, the Department for Health and Social Care cannot offer any more because they don't have the money to offer it. But if they were given the money by the Treasury, that may give rise to a consequential. But we're in the realms of many, many uncertainties and unpredictabilities as we rehearse this question.
Okay, yep, that clarifies it. Thank you. Moving on to tax, I mean, on income tax specifically, I know that Liz Smith and the Conservatives would just like no tax or very little tax, but you're proposing 1p. Other people would have said, well, why not put it up 2 or 3p? And that would just have given us a little bit more money. So can you explain why you chose 1p rather than more or less?
Well, I think it's important to not just consider this as why did I consider 1p, because we've already taken the decision on 1p already. So we have to, you know, this is where it is important. This is where Professor Roy is absolutely right to say to us the government has got to make a careful judgment about the degree to which tax divergence happens. And I think I've got to make a balanced judgment, which I'm confident in, about the budget that I've set out to Parliament in December, that the scale of difference in tax, when considered alongside the scale of difference of the delivery of the public propositions in Scotland around the social contract and the attractiveness of Scotland as a place to live and work, is in sufficient balance to justify the measure that I took. But to go further, I think, might take us into territory that would create some wider difficulties for the Scottish tax base. And I've got to be mindful of the importance of sustaining the Scottish tax base at all times.
Consider, or would you consider, you know, a kind of more radical change so that instead of just 1 or 2p difference, we go like, say, 21, 31, 41, 51, you know, a kind of more bands instead of the kind of jump we have at the moment from 21 to 41?
There's obviously a range of options that can be taken forward in connection with taxation. The government looks at these questions, but obviously sets out its tax position to Parliament when it comes to the conclusion of that exercise. But there are, of course, many other ways in which we could structure our tax system, and that option exists for government to consider those points.
Mm-hmm. And on that point, then, I gather that the only plans really for a new tax or a replacement tax is the aggregates levy, which is due to be devolved at some point. Is that the only kind of new tax that's being looked at, or even to raise council tax, which hasn't really been raised before today, but you know, what about a revamp or replacement for council tax? What's the timescale for that?
Well, obviously, we've got commitments in the Bute House Agreement to take forward discussions on the reform of the council tax, and we will pursue that. There is, of course, also the Visitor Services Levy Bill, which is to come into Parliament, but obviously that would relate to an additional form of local taxation. But the government obviously gives consideration to sources of taxation, but there are a number of one of the other points which I think is relevant to some of the issues the convener raised with me earlier on. If we were to develop any new taxes, we would have to seek the consent of the United Kingdom government in taking those forward. So it's not something that we can just take forward under our own steam.
You know, I do understand that, although I think there was a Scottish survey, I can't remember what it's called exactly, social attitude survey, which said that the public, you know, was open to higher taxes and redistribution. And also the expert panel made the point that on property taxes generally were not very progressive at the moment.
I think there is obviously scope for us to explore many of these questions, and I think what we have done, part of the call there was prior to the budget from not all stakeholders, was for the government to use its powers effectively and comprehensively. I believe we have done so, and I believe we've also done so in a context that is credible, deliverable and in balance. Some of the other proposals that I've seen, I think would have had quite a negative effect on the Scottish tax base and on the Scottish economy and Scottish society. And some of them I just quite simply couldn't take forward. They're not at my gift to do so. So I can only really, you know, I'm confident I have taken the steps that are necessary to the maximum of the scope available to me to take these steps.
Okay, thanks. And the final point I wanted to raise, in your letter to us of the, was it the 20th of December, we'd mentioned it in our report about investment zones, and you said you were kind of waiting to see what the UK government was going to do, because I think they had indicated they were refocusing. Can you say anything about that, or do we just not know what the UK government is doing on that?
Well, if the committee will recall that in the, I don't know what it's called, fiscal event, mini budget, the one in September, there was to be a plethora of investment zones. When the new Prime Minister came into office, I can't remember at which stage. Sorry? Well, sorry, the current Prime Minister came into office. I can't remember at which stage. I think it must have been in my conversation with Michael Gove, I think. It would either be Michael Gove or with John Glenn, the Chief Secretary. I think it was with Michael Gove. He made it clear to me they were not pursuing the plethora of investment zones. It was going to be a much more focused proposition. And that dialogue is underway between us. We're not in a position to share any details about where that has reached. It's at the very early stages, but there is what I am certain about is that the proposition that was available in September is no longer available, and it will be a much more focused proposition that's brought forward.
Thanks so much. Thank you, Kevin.
Thank you. Just one more question from me, and it's just based on what you've been saying with a bit of a glint in your eye, I think, over the last few minutes, which is talking about expectations and predictions. I mean, obviously, you talked about the legal requirement to make the books balance, and you talked about contingency elements being unresolved. But in the interest of transparency, I'm just wondering what kind of sum of money we're actually talking about that remains to be unresolved.
Obviously, that is on a range because there's a number of variables that will be involved. But I think it'd be fair to say that sum varies from, depending on the assumptions, from about £200 to £500 million.
Okay, thank you for that. And on that note, I shall thank the Deputy First Minister for his evidence and also the work of his officials today, and also thank colleagues around the table. That is the meeting ended. Thank you.